Hey there, Mr. Redder here. Welcome back to another episode of r/EntitledPeopleStories. Today we have a very special episode for you, a compilation of some of the best Entitled People stories we've read over the past year. So sit back, relax, and enjoy a few hours of the most entitled people you've ever heard of. And by the way, Karen assured me that for every thumbs up this video gets, she won't try to get anyone fired for an entire week. So please smash that like button and subscribe and turn on notifications for new stories from Reddit every single day. Karen roommate demands I do her taxes. My roommate, 29 female, and I, also 29 female, have been living together for 9 years. This whole time, I filed her taxes every year until last year. Every year, she'd hand me her W-2, Social Security card, and ID, and I'd go to my sister's place to file her taxes online. I get my sister's help because I'm dyslexic and don't want to accidentally mix up any numbers while filing. I would always ask my roommate if she wanted to go with us, and she would refuse, choosing to stay home and watch shows instead. Whenever my sister helps me with taxes, I treat her out for lunch as a thank you, whether this is going to a restaurant, fast food, or getting delivery of her choice. This is where my frustration with my roommate comes in. She would never go with me to file her taxes, saying that she trusted me. I'd take screenshots of everything to show her what was filed, how much she would get, etc. When she'd get her tax return, she'd accuse me of stealing some of it, though I could always prove that I didn't. She never pitched in any money toward treating my sister out for lunch as thanks for help, but would also get mad if we didn't bring back food for her. So last year, I told her that I wasn't going to do her taxes anymore. She whined about not knowing how to do it and being too anxious to go to a professional. I told her that she should have been more involved before, and I don't want to do everything for her. She never went to a professional to get her taxes done and didn't do it herself. She didn't file at all last year. This year, she asked me to do her taxes and I refused. She started crying and said that I'm ruining everything by not helping her. She complained to her friends at work about this, who all told me that I'm being unnecessarily mean and I should help her out because she clearly isn't responsible enough to do this on her own. They told me that she's still young and shouldn't have to worry about it so much. But she and I are literally only 3 months apart in age. She has not filed yet this year, and I'm being told that I'm the jerk for not helping her because she's too anxious to get her taxes done professionally and too insecure to do it herself. At this rate, she may not file this year too, and only my sister is on my side in this. I have really bad social anxiety about seeing a professional, and that's partially why I do my taxes myself with my sister's help. So I understand being anxious, but am I really the jerk for not helping her? Well, who do you think is the jerk? OP or her roommate? Please let us know. I hope you're able to find a new roommate, OP. One who hopefully you won't have to babysit. Am I the jerk for preventing my neighbor from getting high-speed internet? So I recently got high-speed internet to my house after not having it for nearly a decade. I live in an area that has multiple options for broadband, but my house sits back about a mile off the public road, so most utilities need to be hardlined to work. Despite living in a large piece of property, my one and only neighbor is about 800 feet away from me due to the original owners being family members and wanting their homes to be semi-close. We get along, but don't interact much. They have done some things that I consider rude, but they seem like generally okay people. When I first moved in, I worked out a deal with our local internet provider to run a main line to my home if I could get the neighbor to sign up as well. Reason for that is they allow a certain allowance per customer per construction cost. And with two of us, the total was high enough to cover everything. Now, there is no contract, so they could cancel after the first month, and I offered to pay for their services for the first 3 months as a thank you. They declined and said that they were happy with DSL. I explained that they didn't have to get rid of anything. I just needed them to allow the line to be ran underground and sign on for a month minimum, and I'd cover it. Still, no. We planned on buying a new house eventually, so I never had it installed as I didn't want to pay. With everything going on and working from home, I finally worked a deal out that if I did some of the construction, they would cover any extra costs for the installation. Now, my neighbor sees what's going on and comes to ask about our new internet provider. I explained what I had to go through and that he could do the same if he wanted. Next thing I know, an installer is knocking on my door, letting me know he's going to lay cable across my driveway temporarily and that they'll need to dig it up to go across permanently. I asked what he was talking about, and he said he was installing cable for the neighbor. I said, "No, you're not. Not for my property anyway." Now the neighbor is begging me to give them an easement for his cable drop. I said no for two reasons. One, you did me over years ago when I wanted the cable originally. Two, I really don't want them digging into the driveway or having to mow around a wire on the yard all summer. I admit I'm being petty, but I don't think I'm the jerk. I mentioned it to a friend and they went off about how everyone is struggling and that I should be a good neighbor and to stop being a spiteful jerk. So, just to add a couple of things because I've gotten so many questions. Under the original deal 10 years ago, I approached the neighbors about a year after moving in. I explained that I noticed we weren't serviceable by the cable company, so I approached them to find out what had to be done. I explained that the cable company had to agree to doing the work and that I would let them do everything on my property. The cable company required me to put a deposit of $10,000 down, which would be returned after we both got service to our homes. I explained that they didn't have to sign or do anything to proceed, but that I just needed them to sign up for service for a month once it was done so that I could get my deposit back. I offered to pay for that and also offered to pay for their first 3 months of service if they chose to permanently switch. They had zero interest in helping out. This alone has cost me $18,000 over the last 10 years. That deal no longer exists, and with rising costs of everything, I reached out to the cable company again to see what we could do. They agreed to cover above and beyond their normal allowance if I handled excavation. Construction costs were around $70,000. $60,000 of that was installing the hard line back to the PED where the services hook up. So I saved $60,000 by doing the work myself, and the cable company covered the remainder. Well, who do you think is the jerk? OB or their neighbor? Please let us know.
Thank goodness we have AT&T Fiber, ain't that right, Reddit boy?
Entitled mom demands I invite her kids to a party that's not even a party. So, some backstory. My brother is an ER doctor and his husband an ER nurse, so they both work long hours throughout the week. They have twins, we will call them Ann and Ken, not their real names, just the first to pop in my head. Now, because of their workload, me and my sister help throughout the week by taking the kids after school a few days a week. I have them on Mondays, Wednesdays, and Fridays. Well, Friday happens to be my niece and nephew's birthday. Now, due to lockdown, we can't have a big party that they're used to, but I still wanted to make it special. My niece and nephew had become friends with two kids in the building, Sarah and Blake. Again, fake names. Their mother, we will call Nice Neighbor. I had become friends with her. Now, every time my niece and nephew are over, they play with Sarah and Blake. So I told the twins that Sarah and Blake could come over on Friday for a little birthday sleepover. I worked it out with Sarah and Blake's mom and got everything ready. Now here's where Entitled Mom comes in. As I was coming in the building, Entitled Mom ran up to me.
So, you are having a party tonight?
Me. What? No.
Sarah and Blake told my kids that they were going to your niece's party at your apartment.
Me. It's not a party. It's my niece and nephew's birthday, so I told them they could have Sarah and Blake over to watch movies.
Well, my kids are upset that they weren't invited.
Me. Sorry, but like I said, it's not a party. Just my niece and nephew having friends over.
My kids would love a sleepover.
Me. Oh, well then maybe you should throw one.
You could be nice and invite them. It's not nice to leave kids out.
Me. I don't even know your kids. Sarah and Blake have been friends with my niece and nephew for going on 3 years.
Well, they can always get to know each other at the party.
No, my niece doesn't like strange people.
I'm your neighbor. I'm not strange.
You tried to break into my apartment a few days ago.
You're being overly dramatic.
And you're being crazy.
Well, that's rude.
I rolled my eyes and walked away before she could say anything else. Am I the jerk for ignoring my nephew after he stole an important $50 bill from me? There's a story behind that bill, and it mattered a lot to me. My best friend Henry and I knew each other since we were in middle school. In high school, we were pretty adamant about being child-free and swore that we'd never have kids. He decided to make a little bet, though. First guy to have a kid owed the other $50. It was a dumb bet that I didn't really take seriously, and I completely forgot about it until 9 years later. I was with Henry at a diner once for lunch, and he slips me a $50 bill. It took me a minute, but when it clicked, I was so ecstatic. Still one of my fondest memories with him. Two grown men hugging it out at a diner in tears after giving me the news that he's going to be a dad for the first time. His daughter was born after that. I was honored to be her godfather. Then, unfortunately, we lost him all too soon when his daughter was just 5. It's been 3 years since then, and I still miss him. We were like brothers,
and I kept that bill as a memento. I see my goddaughter all the time, so the bill is also a reminder of the first time I learned of her existence. Kept it in a small box with other sentimental things of mine on top of a dresser in my room. My sister is staying with my wife and I, along with my 16-year-old nephew. They all know about this story, by the way. I've told them before many times. A few days ago, I noticed the box was in a different spot than where I left it, and that's when I discovered that the bill was gone. He eventually confessed what he did because I was frantically looking for it all over the place. My nephew needed the money because he wanted to take his girlfriend out to eat, but my sister wouldn't give him any cash since he spent all his allowance money. Honestly, I was so furious and had asked him how he could do that, knowing that it was one of the few things I have of my best friend and he stole it. My nephew kept apologizing, but I couldn't look at him. My emotions were a little too strong and I just wanted to get away from him before I started yelling. My sister offered to pay me back, but she darn well knows that's not the same. However, she's saying I'm being too harsh on him because I've been ignoring him the past couple of days and he's feeling ashamed enough. She's apologized on his behalf, but does think I'm taking it too far. Right now, it's still all too fresh for me. That bill wasn't important to me because of a memory that it holds. Now it's lost and I'll never get it back. I'm not at a place where I want to talk to him yet, but my sister feels like I'm being somewhat of a jerk by punishing him like this as he's already learned his lesson. I'd just like to know if I am. Well, who do you think is the jerk? OP or his nephew? Please let us know. I'd kick out that nephew ASAP and his mom for making excuses for him. Am I the jerk for telling my sister to leave because of her fear? I'm 22, male, and my sister, 17, female, is afraid of snakes. She hates them, can't be near them. My boyfriend, 21, male, is the opposite. He loves them, and we actually have one, who's 2, female. Because of this, we normally go see her, or if she comes to our place, my boyfriend's sister will take our girl for the day. So we have a pool, and it's been really hot where we live, so we invited my sister and my parents around. Like normal, my boyfriend's sister came and took our snake. When they arrived, everything was fine until we got in the pool. My boyfriend has a tattoo of a snake. It's a blacked-out silhouette that wraps around both of his arms and his back. When my sister saw it, she freaked out and told me to tell him to cover it. She knew about his tattoo, she just expected him to cover it, which he can't do without putting on a long-sleeve t-shirt. I told her no. She then went over to him and asked him to leave because he knows about her fear. This annoyed me, and I told her that if she has an issue with it, then she should leave. This is his house, not hers. She got upset and just sat inside the whole time. When they left, my mom told me that I was rude to my sister, and we know about her fear and that we ruined her day. Now I'm starting to think that I could have handled the situation better. So, am I the jerk? Edit. I've been talking to someone in DMs, and they said I should add some stuff we talked about to my post. My boyfriend's tattoo is very important to him. We got our current baby after his old snake passed. The tattoo is based on a picture of his old snake wrapped over his arm and his back. Also, self-expression is very important to my boyfriend. He grew up in a very restrictive household. His mother controlled what he did and how he acted and what he wore. We didn't just move our snake because her enclosure is built into a large bookcase in our living room. Also, this only happens once every month or so. We normally visit her. Also, my boyfriend's sister is a huge reptile nerd and loves our girl almost as much as we do. My boyfriend actually has an irrational animal fear of his own, butterflies. He knows not all phobias work the same, but he thinks that her asking him to leave is ridiculous. Also, when I say that it's his house, I mean it's his house, not ours. Old lady forgets her bank card, nice lady saves the day. Hi all, first time posting, but I've been lurking for a while. I currently work as a cashier at a major grocery store chain in the Pacific Northwest. Believe it or not, I had just been hired the previous week, and this happened yesterday on my first shift on the registers after the mandatory training on the computers in the office. So this happened towards the end of my shift. It was fairly slow, and I was the only cashier at the time, somehow. This sweet old lady walked up and informed me that she'd have to pay by check because she left her bank card at home. I told her that was perfectly fine, but I'd need to call my supervisor over to show me how to use the check scanner, since I'd never done it before. She agreed, and I rang her up uneventfully. My supervisor comes over, and they get the check made out to the right company for the right amount, and she shows me how to scan it into the system. A message pops up on the register, informing me that I need to check her ID and input the driver's license number. I inform her of such, and she seems upset, but not angry. Dialogue is paraphrased, but as close to what was said as I can remember. Old lady.
But I left it at home with my bank card. I remember, I keep them in a small plastic box, so they're together.
Supervisor. I'm sorry to hear that, ma'am. Unfortunately, there's no way to bypass this on the computer. Do you remember your driver's license number by chance? Old lady shakes her head, seeming sad. I'm just sort of standing back with my best sympathetic smile. My manager seems to have things handled, even though there's not much we can do. It's at this point that the customer in line behind old lady speaks up. Nice lady.
If you want to make the checkout to me, I can pay with my bank card.
Old lady cheers up.
Would you? That would be wonderful.
Nice lady.
Yeah, I don't want you to go all the way back home and have to come back just to buy some groceries.
Old lady.
Thank you so much.
Old lady steps to the side to let nice lady put her card in the pin pad. Meanwhile, she makes out the check to nice lady. Once the payment goes through, I hand old lady the receipt, wish her a pleasant evening, and start scanning nice lady stuff. Old lady hands nice lady the finished check, thanks her again, and leaves. Supervisor and I both thank nice lady, and she says something along the lines of,
"She seemed like a safe bet."
I compliment nice lady on her good deed for the day, and the rest of the shift goes by smoothly. Supervisor tells me as I clock out that I did really well for a first day. I'd worked as a cashier before, just never at a grocery store, and asks if I'm coming in tomorrow. I tell her my next shift, grab some groceries of my own, wish supervisor a good night on my way out, and head home. I feel like we could all use a break from the Karens of the world, and this felt like a good story that deserved to be shared. Thanks for reading. Am I the jerk for reporting a family for not telling me that their son was in the house while I was babysitting? Where I am, there's a babysitting service where people around the ages of 16 to 18 who can't get a real job work for. I have the app on my phone and I get notified if the customer selects me for a babysitting session. I got a notification a couple of days ago and everything seemed fine. They had a fourth grader and they just wanted me to keep an eye on him. Their profile said that the kid was a bit unruly and talkative, but I was fine with that. What they didn't say on the app was that they had a son, not sure about his age, but young adult, maybe 19 to 21-ish, in the house I was going to be babysitting in. I wasn't allowed on the second floor, so I was in the living room with the kid. I was on my phone and I had a heart attack when I saw some random adult man about 6 feet tall and big just come from the stairwell to where I was. He didn't acknowledge me and he walked by and got some food from the kitchen and went back upstairs. I genuinely thought he was a home invader before realizing he came from upstairs and he was wearing homeware, so he had to be family. He didn't do anything to me, but I was freaked out. I was literally in a bad situation because I'm 5'3" and I'm 16 and I was in an unfamiliar house with a fully grown big dude. Like, it's a classic get out of there situation. I had about 4 hours left and I didn't want a bad review, so I stayed there against all gut feelings. About 20 minutes or so later, I bumped into him again and he asked me, "Are you the babysitter?" I said yes, and he said I was allowed to use the second floor because the only reason I wasn't was because his parents didn't want me bumping into him, which already happened. I thanked him but stayed on the first floor. After the session, I was furious for the situation I was put in. I wanted to call them and tell them that was not okay, but I needed their review, so I kept quiet. Later on, after they reviewed me, I reported them for not being clear with me about the situation at home. I told my friends about this because I don't know why they chose a 16-year-old girl to babysit their kid when they had a full-grown man in the house who seemed capable. And they told me reporting them was kind of a jerky thing to do because, one, they would be permanently banned, and so I was denying the kid ever getting a babysitter. Two, I waited for a review, then I reported them. Three, the guy didn't do anything to me and was harmless. Now I'm conflicted, but I have 48 hours to call back for a report. So I need to know, am I the jerk? Well, what do you think? Is OP the jerk for reporting this family or not? Please let us know. My neighbor is bringing dangerous animals into our neighborhood. For some context, I live in Pennsylvania, 1 mile outside of a major city. My neighbor, 65 female, and her husband are from California. They purchased the house behind me online without ever visiting the area or apparently Google mapping the area because the house is surrounded by trees and we just love wildlife. We live on a soon-to-be 5-lane road that people use as an alternative to the interstate. There's two shopping malls and a major grocery store 1/4 mile down the road.
Basically, we are not in the wilderness and live in an extended neighborhood amongst businesses and strip malls. Across the busy road is a mountain that is virtually untouched by humans. This woman is a huge activist, environmentalist, and vegan, and thinks the Game Commission is meant to hurt animals for fun. She has lived here in a residential neighborhood right outside of a city in a huge pro-hunting state for 3 years. When they moved in, they had termites and asked the exterminator to trap and release the termites. She also has not left her property in 2 years because,
"I just can't bear to see roadkill."
This is my neighbor. 2 years ago, we noticed a massive influx of squirrels. I had grandma confirm this. Not only was there a lot of squirrels, but they were also fat and not afraid of humans. That's when we noticed that 2 times a day, this psycho is throwing about 5 pounds of birdseed and nuts on the ground because
the squirrels depend on me to survive.
We've had squirrels hiding nuts in our house walls. Squirrels took over my husband's workshop and they rip up all the flower beds hiding their nuts. My husband kindly asked her to stop, since what is not eaten will bring rats and mice. Plus, encouraging squirrels, rabbits, etc. to the immediate area will eventually bring dangerous animals as well. And he reminded her that squirrels will lose their instinct to forage the longer they have a human food source to replace the need to look for food. He was right about the dangerous animals. Last year, we had 4 separate bears reported within a 3-square-mile area of residential neighborhoods, as well as bobcats making a weekly appearance that we could hear. We ended up reporting her to the Game Commission 3 times last year, and they found multiple bear poop piles in her yard. Game Commission told her that she was responsible for the bears and ended up sending her a certified letter banning her from feeding any wildlife within our state. She didn't listen, and all winter I watched this lunatic sweep away snow in the grass to scatter her pounds of seed and nuts on the ground. Now spring is here, and we have a mama bear with 3 cubs roaming the area, as well as 2 other lone bears. I love wildlife, but if I wanted to live among it, I would have bought a house on the other side of the mountain, like she should have. My issue with her is these animals are coming down from the mountain and crossing a very busy road to get to her daily/nightly buffet. It's not safe for the animals to be inadvertently luring them off the mountain. Last year, we had 2 bears hit by cars within a 1/2 mile of our house. One of them was relocated by the Game Commission 1 hour away, came all the way back to the area, and was hit crossing the road in front of my house. At this point, I don't know what to do with this whack job. Clearly, reporting her does not help. She's so consumed with helping wildlife that she refuses to see that she's harming it instead. On top of it, we are all only living in this house until it's rezoned commercial and can sell it. She's so concerned for the wildlife/environment and is raising heck at township meetings about any major projects moving forward. I want her gone, or at the least, be told to shut up. Well, what would you do in this situation? Please let us know.
Maybe we can get one of the bears to eat her.
Am I the jerk for kicking my 3 sisters out of my wedding after they came with their kids? My wife and I got married 2 weeks ago. We wanted a child-free wedding, so we've let everyone know, my family, in-laws, and friends, and relatives, and everyone was okay with it, except for my family. I have 3 sisters, all with kids from 2 to 10. My mom said it was illogical to not allow kids, since 1, this never happened in the family, and 2, my sisters live towns away, so the kids can't be left alone. After a lot of arguing and others getting involved, I stood my ground, and they agreed to not bring kids. At the wedding, no one brought kids. My parents and aunts were already there. But then I saw my 2 sisters arriving with their kids. I immediately went to ask what's the deal. They began arguing with me when I said I won't be letting them in with the kids. I saw my older sister come with her kids in the car. I was upset. I asked why they decided to go against the rule and bring kids. My mom started yelling at me when I told my sisters they weren't allowed in with them. Everyone was yelling at me. I had to get the security involved to make them leave. My parents and aunt left shortly after. They were so upset with me. I got nasty texts and a letter, and my cousin posted about my crappy wedding on Facebook. Days later, I've gathered the family and explained that what they did was wrong. I asked if I allowed my sisters with their kids, what message does that send to my in-laws and friends who wanted to bring kids but they couldn't? My sisters argued with me, and it turned out my mom told them to bring their kids and she'd deal with me later. I told them they could have arranged for a babysitter, but my mom said they wanted to celebrate as a whole family. Said that I ruined my own wedding by making a scene, and everyone will always remember my wedding as a disaster. A crap show because of mine and my wife's child-free bull. They said the only way to fix it is to have another wedding slash party and include everyone, especially the kids. I called them unreasonable. I asked Mom where the heck she got the nerve to even demand that. They blamed my wife and claimed it was deliberate. I left. They started talking to my wife, trying to convince her that they don't approve of what happened and that they're giving us the chance to fix the situation. Otherwise, the relationship is damaged. This caused me a headache, and I don't think what I did was wrong. I just wanted them to have some respect for my wife and her family. Well, who do you agree with? OP or his mom and his sisters? Please let us know. I can't believe how disrespectful they were to you. Entitled mom loses it when I block her daughter on social media. So, this was this morning and I am a bit upset. My ex-friend decided to block me on all social media because of a text message stream we had back in November of last year. I'll try to rewrite it here. Also, we're both 14, if that clarifies anything. Friend. So I like other friend's name. How about you? Me. I like you. Friend blocks me. Now I'm confused and I asked her friends why she did that. They all say it's because she hates me for putting her on the spot like that. For the rest of middle school, she bullied me and got her friends to as well whenever they saw me. During quarantine, I guess she unblocked me because I got a text from her saying, "Hey, I'm sorry about what I did. Can we be friends?" I thought about this for a bit, and I hate being rude to people, so I just said sure. Now her friends at golf think we're dating. She calls me names like Boo and Babe, even though I have asked her not to. This was my final text message with her. Me. I don't understand why you're calling me this. We aren't dating. Friend. Yes, we are. You asked me out when you accepted my friendship again. Me. I never meant it that way, and if you think that, then I'm breaking up with you. Friend. You can't do that. I'll choose when we're over. Me. Alright. Bye. I block her. A few days later, or this morning, I get a knock on my door. I open it to see friend bawling with her mother entitled mom. Me. May I ask why you're here? Entitled mom. How dare you break up with my daughter? Me. We weren't even date. Yes, you were, you little jerk. You're such a jerk for ruining my daughter's life. At this point, I start to close the door, knowing I won't get anywhere by talking to them when the entitled mom juts her foot out to keep the door open. She is significantly larger than me, so she can easily overpower me and manages to get into the house. Me. Get out of my house! Entitled mom. I won't leave until you agree to date my daughter again. I pull out my phone and call the cops while trying to make sure entitled mom doesn't go anywhere. I was home alone, so my parents couldn't exactly help, considering they were at work. About 15 minutes later of arguing, the police arrive and start asking questions. Officer, what seems to be the problem? Entitled mom. He attacked me. Me. Actually, she broke into the house and demanded I date her daughter. Officer. Ma'am, please step outside. No, this little jerk needs to date my daughter. The police officer was chill the whole time and eventually got her off my property. I still have friend blocked and haven't heard from them yet. I haven't pressed charges and it seems to have mellowed out. I'll update if anything happens. Edit. For everyone saying to press charges, we decided against it. She doesn't have a great life. The dad is out of the picture and we don't want to make it worse. Thanks for all the support though. Most of y'all have given positive feedback and I thank the nice people for that. We are, however, going for a restraining order, and I'll update when that happens. Am I the jerk for taking my son to a plastic surgeon without his mom knowing? We have a 12-year-old son who spends 50-50 with me and his mother. He had these two moles on his face, one on his left cheek and the other on the corner of his nose. He's become quite sensitive about it lately and wanted them removed. He's been very vocal about it. I took him to the doctor for something unrelated and asked him about it. He gave me a number of another doctor who happens to be a plastic surgeon. We had a consultation with the plastic surgeon who said it was no problem removing them with a scalpel. In fact, he offered to do it right then and there because it would take less than 10 minutes. Otherwise, we would have to schedule something and the next appointment would be in October. I asked my son if he wanted to and he said yes. My son just needed one stitch and is healing quickly. He's quite happy with the results. I dropped him off today at his mom's and she went nuclear over his moles being removed. She said that I should have asked her before getting the procedure done and that our son had plastic surgery. I explained to her that he's old enough to make his own choices on the matter and that the doctor offered to do it at the consultation. Plus, it's not really a big deal. We're talking about two moles. That's why I didn't call her. It's like a parent getting mad at another parent for not consulting them over their 12-year-old's nail polish color. Edit. Mole removal is a simple procedure. Edit. For people asking why I didn't wait until October, he has school pictures next Thursday. He didn't want to take a picture with the moles on his face, so the opportunity came to remove his moles and I took it. If I had stopped and consulted my ex, then she would have gotten all riled up over two moles. I still would have signed off even if she said no. That would have upset her even more. Well, what do you think? Should he have gotten permission from his mother before he did this or not? Please let us know. Entitled patient lied to my boss about me, so I got her discharged from the hospital. I always listen to these stories on YouTube, and I never thought I would have a story to post here, but here I am. For context, I work in a hospital that specializes in elective surgeries. Therefore, a vast majority of the patients that come into my office are people willing to pay thousands of dollars out of pocket to fix physical, but not life-threatening issues. My boss is considered the best in his field throughout the entire world, and it's particularly difficult to schedule an appointment with him unless it's months in advance. I received a phone call from this woman, let's call her Entitled Jerk, and the conversation is as follows. Me. Doctor's office, how can I help you? Karen. I need an appointment so I can schedule surgery, and I was told by the doctor through email to call to be scheduled next week. Me, confused. I'm sorry, I'm not too certain what you're referring to. The doctor is not going to be in the office next week, and their next availability for consultations is not until May. What are you talking about? They told me in the email to call to schedule it, and I am a sitting judge, so I need an appointment next week. Me. Okay, ma'am, give me one moment while I look into this. I put her on hold and walk into my supervisor's office and ask if the boss had sent word about a last-minute patient being added on that I was just unaware about. They say no, but to ask if the patient can forward the email so we can confirm as boss was in the OR. This is a common practice in the office I work in, as there are instances where boss talks to a patient but forgets to inform the staff. If we are overbooked for a day, my supervisor has to open a specific time frame in order to schedule any last-minute patients. Me takes her off hold. I'm sorry, ma'am, but are you able to forward the email to me? It does not seem there is any record of you coming to our office for an earlier appointment. I just need to confirm before I schedule. For some reason, this statement activates some secret emotional bomb in the back of this woman's brain, and she immediately becomes more hostile. Karen. No, I will not. I am a sitting judge, and you are asking me this is extremely rude and unprofessional. I spoke to the doctor through email. Are you actually doubting me right now? Me. Yes. I can't believe this. I need to have surgery on X date, and you will give it to me. Me. 1000% over this woman at this point. Okay, ma'am. I will ask my boss to send me the email when he is out of the OR. So I unfortunately have to get back to you on your appointment date. Thank you. As just a word of advice, watch your tone the next time you speak to me. Me. Okay. Click. A few hours later, my boss comes back into the OR and tells me they have received an email from Karen stating that I was rude and unprofessional to her and that I was refusing services to her because I wanted to invade her privacy and she said no. Luckily, the whole time I was on the phone with this patient, my supervisor was in the office listening to the entire call on speakerphone. Otherwise, no one would have been able to confirm that I was not being unreasonable and rude to this patient. My boss goes on to explain that they never promised an earlier appointment to her in the first place, but to check with the office to be put on the wait list for an earlier date. Now, knowing that Karen is nothing but a miserable liar that throws tantrums when no one believes her, I asked my boss if it was really worth it keeping her as a patient, to which they said no. While I was happy with this decision because I don't have to deal with Karen anymore, I felt bad for any other physician that had to deal with this lady in the future. What I didn't know at this point was that my supervisor called patient advocacy, essentially an HR that handles awful patients, and they agreed that her behavior warranted her not to be accepted as a patient by any physician within the hospital. So now my boss, supervisor, and I have to call her tomorrow to inform the hospital's decision to discharge her. Honestly, karma is not something you should mess with. Entitled parents think they can park in my driveway. I get their car towed. I used to live on the bottom floor of a two-story house in a very popular beach town in North Carolina. I was in my mid-20s. The upstairs was rented out to four college-aged guys, so five people, five-car driveway built for four, so one of us would either be on the grass or in a paid spot. If you had bills with your name and address, the city would give you a pass to park in certain paid spaces. So not a big deal, but finding a spot in the middle of summer was hard. The house is maybe 100 yards to the beach,
pretty short walk, 5 minutes tops, with beach gear and little ones. I would leave to work at 6:30 a.m. and return around 5 or 6 p.m. By the time I got home, most of the crowds would be gone, so a paid spot was easy for me to get. So I typically leave the driveway for the upstairs guys. One day I was running late and didn't get out of my house until nearly 8. The other guys had left and the driveway was empty. I'm walking out to my car, and of course the lots are already 90% full or more. As I'm crossing the street, I see a minivan coming up and pulling into my driveway. I didn't recognize it, so I waited to see if I knew them or if they knew the upstairs guys. Out steps polo shirt, visor bowling short dad, and overly peppy mom with 3 screaming kids. Obviously no one I knew. I backtrack up. "Excuse me, do you know the tenants upstairs or have permission to park here?" Entitled mom. "It doesn't matter. No one's parked here, and Billy, Bobby, and Brandy have to get to the beach." Me. "There's 5 people that live here, including myself, and we need to be able to park." Entitled mom.
"Oh, so where's your car if you live there?"
Me. "In that spot there, because I have a pass." Entitled dad.
"Don't lie to us. You're here just the same as us, and upset we know how to park for free."
Me. "I'm not lying. Dude, it's 8 a.m. I'm wearing my work uniform." Entitled mom.
"We don't need to listen to you. We're going to park, and you can do whatever you want. My kids have to get to the beach. You're ruining our vacation, so go away."
Meanwhile, the kids are climbing on my fence and trees in and out of the street. Me. "Okay, I'll just have you towed, and you can deal with it later." Entitled dad gets in my face, practically nose to nose.
"Try it and see. This isn't your house. You're just a little jerk."
Mind you, I'm 5'11" and roughly 190 pounds, fairly good shape. Me. "Okay, have a nice day." So I went to my car and waited until they were pretty much at the beach, like I said. Very short walk. So I go inside, look up a tow service on the other side of town. "Hello, yes, I'd like to report a car illegally parked on my property. Address, 123 street name." "Sir, that's an hour away." "Yeah, I know, I'm not paying. That's their problem." "Okay, be there in about an hour and a half." Called my boss. "Not gonna be in today." Explained what happened, and he's a pretty easygoing guy. Told me to keep him informed. Tow truck arrives, van gone. I leave my car in the spot and wait. It's 10:30 a.m. or so by now. Sometime around 2 or 3 p.m., there's a very angry knock at my door. Internal thoughts, this is gonna be fun. Imagine the shock when I answer the door, beer in hand, grinning like an idiot. Me. "Can I help you?" Entitled dad and entitled mom.
"Where is our van? How did you get here?"
Me. "Oh yeah, here's the card. I had it towed across town. Gonna be a fun cab ride." Shut the door in their face. More angry yelling and knocking. Me. "Yes?" Entitled dad, trying to get into my house.
"You better get us our van back. I'm gonna kick your butt. I'll have you arrested."
Me. "Get out of my house and call the cops. Not gonna change anything." I managed to shove him out of the door and get it closed and locked. Now I wait. Next 20 minutes, more angry knocking and yelling. Finally, about 4 p.m.-ish, I see some blue lights and there's a much more polite knock at my door. I grew up on the beach. It's a small number of locals. I know 70% of the locals, police, bartenders, shop owners, residents. I know a lot of people on the island. Me. "Oh, hey Garrett, how's it going?" Garrett. "Yeah, it's good. These people say you stole their van and broke into this house." Me. "Nope. They pulled into the driveway as I was leaving for work, pulled an attitude, walked away, said I couldn't do anything. So I called Lou on the other side of town. Van's there. I even gave them his card and offered to let them use my phone." Entitled mom.
"He's lying. He stole our car. I demand he be arrested."
Entitled dad, storming up behind the officer.
"If you don't arrest him, I'll have you fired. This is ridiculous. Blah, blah, blah."
Garrett. "Sir, back up. I'm going to figure this out." Entitled dad, now shoving past the officer.
"This is BS.
Working his way into my house again, Garrett is able to pull him out and manages to get him pressed up against his cop car.
"Sir, you are trespassing now."
Looking over at me.
"Would you like to press charges?"
Me. "Can you keep him in your car until they get a cab?"
"Yeah, I mean, I've got to get statements and everything."
So I gave my statement, went inside, grabbed a beer, went out the back door, up the back steps, and around to the second floor porch, and there I sat, smiling, until a cab came at about 5 or 5:30. My upstairs neighbors showed up, but they didn't play any part in the story.
Well, what would you do in this situation? Would you get someone's car towed if they parked in your parking spot or not? Please let us know.
Getting cars towed is a favorite pastime of mine.
This is exactly what happens when you've worked retail for far too long. A long time ago, I used to work in an educational toy store in my local mall. After it closed down, I had to find a new place to shop for the kids in my life. I had gotten a nephew of mine started on a scale Wood Thomas the Train toy line. When someone I knew told me Barnes & Noble had started carrying the line, so I decided to swing by to see what new pieces had come out for the holidays. Once there, I start looking and overhear two women talking about if they should be getting their kids started, because both kids love Thomas the Train. Before I could stop myself, I had introduced myself, and when I mentioned the store I had worked at, they both lit up, suddenly remembering they had seen me there. Now they were asking questions, and I'm giving advice. About the time they're done, more people have started asking more questions. Before I knew it, I've been standing there in the same spot for more than an hour, just selling the heck out of these trains. When the crowd finally dispersed, I make sure I have the two pieces I wanted and start to head to the register, only to find the department manager, the store manager standing there, along with the girl actually working the kids section staring at me. To make this faster, let's call them store manager, department manager, and employee, and we've got me. At this point, realizing the spectacle I had unintentionally created, I walked over expecting to apologize, only to have the store manager start talking before me. Store manager: do you realize how much of that stuff you sold? Me: so that guy did buy the roundhouse set. So you know, that set was at the time their biggest set and cost $500. Store manager: actually, yes, he did. But I'm talking about more than that. You've sold more Thomas the Train items than we have ever sold. Unable to stop myself, I replied, well, you haven't carried that line long. Once your people learn more about it, I'm sure you'll have better numbers. Store manager: do you want a job as assistant manager in this department? Department manager: more than half those people thought you already worked here. They wanted you to get a raise. Employee: I don't understand how you knew all that. I could barely follow half of it. Me: thanks. How much would it pay? Okay, this got away from me. So let's try for a quick finish. I turned the job down. It was offering less money than my job at the time. I ended up being given the employee discount on the two pieces I wanted as a thank you. For about 2 years, every time I went into that Barnes & Noble, I would see one of the managers from that day, and they would ask me if I needed any more train items. Sorry if it was a long one. Hope you enjoyed it. He should have just paid his part. Some background. I'm the manager of a tight-knit extracurricular activity business. My boss is the owner. We serve kids and adults. We run on a membership-based system. More background. Mom brings in her four boys 2 years ago to attend with us. Mom and Dad split last year. Court-ordered custody agreement says that he pays 90% and she pays 10% for all extracurriculars based on their income. I'll try to keep this short. After Mom and Dad split, crap hit the fan for those people. We have several divorced parents working to get their kids here when they can, but Dad just never seems to want to. Since we operate with memberships, kind of like a gym, if you don't come in, you're wasting your money. Every Friday, I call our people who've been absent for more than 4 days. Every other week, they're out completely. I look into it a bit further with Mom, who attended with us before her kids started, and those are the weeks Dad has them. This has happened before, and it's an easy enough fix. We take the parent who isn't cooperating through our program and help them understand the benefits their kids are getting out of it. He watched them a few times when they would come in and started to see that they enjoyed it and the value in the program. Crisis averted, he's bringing the kids again. Since the divorce, Dad hasn't been super forthcoming with money, and with Mom being the primary and not having the funds due to the ongoing divorce proceedings, my boss forfeited 11 months of payments for these people, totaling $3,060. My boss put her foot down 2 weeks ago, right before the one-year mark for them. We couldn't keep not letting them pay us. Mom comes in, we give her the business. She's cool about it, understands that we have a business to run. Sets up her court-ordered 10% on a typical payment plan that we do, $408 over a 12-month period. We email Dad, because at this time, he's just giving them to Mom to take here nearly every day. We don't typically invoice people, usually just set it up in-house with them in front of us, so having to write out that he owes us $3,672 over the next year was tough. Dad doesn't check his email. Cool, fine, whatever. This morning, I call because first payments are due this week. I gave him the business. His reply was,
Yeah, I saw the email. I can't pay anything until the court orders extracurriculars because the child support is way too high. But I really like the program y'all have. Okay, I just think to myself, right. We have the court documents that say how much he had to spend on us. That's cool. I type up all of the call transcript and send it back to him and CC mom with a note that my boss would be calling to set up payments this week. Mom texts me immediately, calling his BS, because he hasn't paid her for giving self a cent of child support, ordered 6 months ago. Same document she provided us. Then Dad replies, the first reply he sent to any email we've sent him. He wanted to make sure that we knew the continue if the child support schedule is complete and there is money to put to it. Possibly is mom pays her half is out the conversation. I didn't quite understand what he meant, but I interpreted as the child support schedule isn't set up yet, so I won't pay until mom pays. But we had sent him the invoice showing him that mom paid. After a while, I stopped trying to understand. It just wasn't worth it. I sent the invoice to both the lawyers listed on the court document and let them take it to court. Dad refused to pay even after he was found in contempt of court for refusing to pay for the kids' extracurriculars. I've genuinely never met anyone this stubborn. Revenge starts here. So we end up having to take Dad to court because he ended up signing a contract with us to pay and he's refused again and again. Our non-payments clause allows us to request payment in full if you have too many problems with the payments. The full amount listed on the contract he signed was $4,080 minus the mom's portion. So my boss, the lovely one she is, decided we can and would request payment in full. But not just his portion, the entire $4,080. My boss also pulled out the $3,060 that we waived and the judge made him pay that too. Dad didn't want to pay $3,672, so he ends up paying $7,140. Am I the jerk for spending my daughter's wedding fund on a car and a trip after she got eloped? My only child, Diana, and her now husband started dating in college and had been engaged just before the lockdown hit. After not being able to really plan for over a year due to everything, they decided a couple weeks ago to just take a trip, the two of them, and elope. I'm very happy for them, and honestly, I'm just glad to not have to deal with the stress of wedding planning. I had $35,000 about set aside for her wedding in an account I've had for a long time. After she told me the news, I was thrilled to be able to put it to other use. My car has been having some trouble lately, so I decided to just treat myself and get a new car in cash with the wedding fund. I paid about $30,000, and with the rest of the money, my wife and I decided we would take our own little getaway. I didn't think this was controversial. Then this past weekend, Diana was over and asked if, since I didn't have to pay for a big wedding, if they could get the money to use towards a down payment. I told her sorry, but that's how I paid for my new car and will be paying for my upcoming trip. To say she was upset is an understatement. I figured I'd just let her cool off, but then last night, my ex, her mom, called me to tell me that I made a selfish move and said some things that I won't repeat. I never told her it was a wedding or whatever she wanted fund, so I didn't think I did anything wrong. Would really appreciate some non-biased perspectives. Edit. Sorry if I worded this poorly. I'm not the best writer. I'm a blue-collar guy. She knew that I had money put aside for her wedding. It was something we talked about when she first got engaged over a year ago, but it's came up at times before that too. Just something I planned for due to having a daughter. I never told her it was a fund for her to use on whatever. I paid for her college and planned on paying for her wedding, but beyond that, didn't plan on paying her way through life. I've gotten lots of comments about being divorced or rich for having savings, but have no clue where that comes from. Her mother and I had her at 19 and were never married. I've done well for myself, considering I never went to college, but I'm definitely not wealthy. Not sure why that is relevant, but want to correct all those claims. Final response. This blew up way more than expected overnight. A lot of people have inserted their own assumptions out of nowhere. Promises that never happened, tension between stepmother, riches I don't have, an obsession with her getting married even though I said I was relieved she eloped, etc. Which is odd. Basically, what I've gathered from the vast majority is that I didn't do anything wrong, but I should have communicated more clearly. I thought that I was crystal clear, but I see now that I could have been even more clear. Thank you everyone for your time. Well, who do you agree with? OP or his daughter? Please let us know. Please leave a comment about this one. I really can't wait to read what you think about it. Am I the jerk for refusing to stop putting out food for the ducks and geese in my neighborhood? I live in a northern climate and have always put out food for ducks and geese.
I put out cracked corn, oats, and sometimes some veggie scraps from my cooking. I used to only do it during the winter when I know food can be scarce. But after a few years, I started having ducks and geese come to my yard during the spring looking for food. So I started putting stuff out for them year-round. There are no regulations regarding this in the city where I live, and for the most part, I haven't had any problem with neighbors. Until recently. My next-door neighbors, a family of four, are in the process of selling their house. The housing market where we live has been crazy so far this year, and houses are selling incredibly fast, and in many cases, for far more than the asking price. Except my neighbor's house has been on the market since before Christmas and still hasn't sold. Like the majority of houses in my neighborhood, it's an old 50s-style rambler that is in need of some work and updating. But it's not been sold yet, and my neighbors are blaming me for it. They say that whenever they have a showing or an open house, my yard is filled with ducks and geese, and it turns off potential buyers. They angrily demanded, not asked, that I stopped feeding the ducks and geese so that they can sell their home. I told them that their home not selling was not my problem, and that I would continue to put out food for the ducks and geese like I always have. They threatened to call the city and the police, and I told them to go ahead. Sure enough, I got a visit from the city, and they asked some questions about the type of food I put out for the birds, and asked me to prove that I was indeed putting out food suitable for them. They left satisfied with my answers and told me that I was doing nothing wrong according to the city regulations. Last weekend, my neighbors had another open house, and as usual, my yard had a few ducks and geese in it. Less than usual, as there are plenty of other food options available for them now, but maybe a dozen total birds. After the open house, the husband of the family came over and knocked on my door and started yelling at me that they had two potential buyers back out of deals directly because of me feeding the birds. He just kept yelling at me that it was my fault that they can't sell their house and that I'm the one obstacle keeping them from moving. I was very uncomfortable with how aggressive he seemed, so I told him that he needed to leave my property or I was going to call the cops. He left, but he called me a bunch of names as he walked away, and the whole encounter left me kind of rattled. I live alone, and feeding the birds is one of the few joys I have in my life. Am I the jerk for refusing to stop? Should I just stop until their house sells? Well, who do you agree with? OP or her neighbors? Please let us know.
That's one good thing about an HOA. You'll never have to worry about a petting zoo next door.
The company appreciates your long and devoted service. Have a frying pan. I worked in the London office of a large, respected, and well-known international but US-based organization who liked to profess/believe/pretend they were a caring, sharing, benign, and PC employer who truly cared about members of the corporate family and only had our best interests at heart while they did us over. The usual. Years of pay freezes over for us, job vacancies unfilled, doubling our workload, essential equipment left obsolete, etc., etc., while the bosses gave themselves increasingly huge bonuses, fancy titles, and perks. They were particularly proud of their Corporate Employee Service Recognition Awards scheme, which had its own dedicated catalog and latterly website, where on achieving so many years of serfdom, a choice from a new cornucopia of appreciative gifts would be lavished upon you, with due ceremony along with a poorly mimeographed certificate of service. I failed to keep a hard copy, which I regret, but certain items we would select remain seared in my memory. 15 years service, for example, could be awarded with a ring containing a 0.01 carat block diamond, aka coal. Another option at 25 years could be an orange cast iron skillet. You get the picture. Another was something only available to our US colleagues for whom there was no mandatory retirement. 60-year service could earn you the ultimate, a cheap Chinese-made 16-speed racing bicycle. Given that, at an absolute minimum, you'd have to be 76 to get this, the joke was that you were encouraged to ride it in heavy traffic in order to get the company off their pension obligations. Which brings me to our little collective attempt at malicious compliance. It took the company several years to catch on, but when a home gymnasium setup strangely became available at a 25-year service award, it immediately became the go-to choice of all of my worldwide colleagues. Why? Not for any desire for fitness, but because all these things had to be sourced and shipped from the States. Shipping for a crappy, but hugely bulky and heavyweight frame, dumbbells and all of the weights to Sydney, Delhi, or wherever probably cost the company at the very least 20 times the value of the item, not to mention the customs duties and import fees. I think this went on for about 5 years before the bean counters clocked it. Myself, I missed out, and had to settle for the orange frying pan to remind me how much they valued my 25 years of servitude. It's mounted on the wall for my grandchildren to revere. Edit. Thank you to all of you lovely people for all of the likes, and even those couples of awards, which I value more than any orange frying pan I've ever received. I've obviously hit a bit of a common nerve among many of you. To those of you who have received long service awards that actually do make you feel appreciated, I'm delighted for you. For the rest of us, I think we're all pretty much agreed that these derisory awards are really just an insult, rubbing in just how little we are valued. Better nothing than a piece of worthless crap. It's not a matter of financial value. A simple, heartfelt, personalized letter from almost anyone further up the food chain, honestly recognizing my service and efforts, would have meant immeasurably more to me than any trinket. You want me to do a worse job intentionally? Okay. I work in IT, and my first job was a Tier 1 tech support agent for a call center. Our company had contracts with a lot of smaller ISPs, and we would take a high volume of calls for various types of issues depending on who called in. For me, 40 calls in a day was pretty much normal. Unlike most people who are just reading a script and collecting a check, I always had a vested interest in technology and also held some IT certifications, which was not the norm here. I was really good at solving technical problems for customers and worked really hard. After working there for a few months, management decided they wanted to start micromanaging the heck out of people and made up tons of strict metrics that they thought sounded good but were not backed by actual data to implement. One of their metrics is they wanted people to target a 12-minute call time with a customer, and anything over 20 minutes was really bad. That sounds reasonable, but they did not account for people who were really good at their job and resolved a lot of issues. My call times would fluctuate between 6 to 7 minutes because, again, I was skilled at problem solving in this area, and I resolved all of the customer issues I could. It turns out that people who had under 9-minute call times would lose points on their rating because it was so much under the average. So my scores in the spreadsheet were failing because I was too fast. My supervisor was scored on his agent's performance, so his score was also really bad due to the fact I was good at my job and scoring a 0 every week for the average handle time. The contracts we had with these companies we supported paid out to our company based on things like tickets created, issues resolved, number of calls, etc. So I was essentially making the company 2 to 3 times as much as a slow agent per night I clocked into work. However, because of our amazing performance rating system, my ability to do my job well was hurting both my score and my supervisor's score and getting both of us in trouble. They had a team of a couple leads listen to all of my calls to figure out what I was cheating on or not doing that was in the process for our clients to make my call time so short. But I had everything I was supposed to and all of my tickets and was resolving issues, so they found nothing. When we had our weekly one-on-one meeting after this had been going on for a couple weeks, my supervisor specifically told me that he wanted me to do a worse job from this point forward because it would help both of us. He wanted me to add in random small talk, resolve things slower, and type up my tickets slower. At first, I was in disbelief and attempted to argue this, but then I was like, okay, if that's really what you want, I can do it. So that night, I talked to random customers about Destiny 2 and other nonsense and made the company less money because that's exactly what they wanted. And what do you know? I never got in trouble for call times again. Am I the jerk for not agreeing to a name change for my daughter despite her father wanting one? My ex and I were engaged, living together, and planning on trying for kids after the wedding. The wedding got delayed and I found out I was pregnant shortly after. My ex freaked out, insisted it couldn't be his baby because he wasn't ready to be a dad, that this was all happening too fast and it wasn't how we planned it, and said he needed some time to think everything over. He then moved out, blocked me, and didn't answer any kind of attempted contact for 10 months. Our child was born without him there, and I named our daughter Elizabeth Laura Smith, without his input. Elizabeth because I like it, and it reminds me of my favorite book character. I work in literature. Laura after my grandmother, and Smith is my surname. My ex has reached out. He said he waited this long because he wasn't sure how far along I was when we were together, but he figured the baby had to have been born by now. I said that his timing was a little off because she's 5 months old. X has said he's planning to sort out custody. We've not discussed logistics yet, but he's unlikely to get anything before she turns 1. He asked if I'd named her yet, and I told him what I'd named her. X then said he hates that name. He thinks it sounds old and stuffy. He says that as his mother, Mary, has recently passed, November 2019, he wants to name our daughter Mary. He says Mary must be the first name and that I can have either Elizabeth or Laura as the middle name. I made clear, in no uncertain terms, that I will not change her name. I hate the name Mary. I hate how it sounds, both alone with Elizabeth slash Laura Smith on the end of it. Plus, I didn't like his mother either, though I didn't remind him of that. X said that if we're going to co-parent, then I have to learn to compromise, and that this is the place to start, and that it's unfair that I got to choose both her first and middle name. I said that if he hadn't blocked me for the better part of a year, he'd have been able to say all of this when she was born. X said that the above is proof that I'm being petty and that he can't undo the past, but I can prevent any feelings of dislike or resentment from him over this name in the future, and that as the father, he should have a say in his daughter's name. He also says that he's willing to let her be a Smith and not force me to use his surname, which he feels is proof he has already negotiated. Am I the jerk? Karen's sister demands I buy better presents for her kids. I'm a 23-year-old female with two young nephews. I enjoy reading. I have a home office slash library that has half the room as bookshelves filled with books of all kinds, from school textbooks and research books to fantasy and kids' books. I admit I am a bookworm. Anyway, my nephews have started reading a lot more, so I decided to buy them some of my favorite books to read as a kid. Books like The Magic Treehouse, Geronimo Stilton, and The Enchanted Castle, etc. When I went over to give them the books, my nephews looked at them for a few minutes, then threw them down on the ground. We were outside on the back porch. My nephews started asking what else I brought for them, and why I gave them smelly, boring old books. The books were brand new, still had the stickers on and everything. I thought maybe they were just being kids, because, you know, they're kids. But when I explained I just brought the books for them, they threw a huge tantrum. They were screaming and crying about why I didn't buy them video games and toys instead, and just gave them stupid books. They started stomping all over the books on the ground. Their mother slash my sister did not stop them. In fact, she scolded me for not getting them something they really wanted, like video games. I started arguing with her that she had told me that they loved books and they wanted to read more, so that's why I got them the books. I thought they would enjoy these books as I did as a kid. My sister screamed at me about being self-absorbed and how not everyone loved books like I did. But she was the one who told me that my nephews really loved books like I did, repeatedly. I knew I was getting nowhere with this argument and my nephews screaming in the background, so I picked up all of the books off the ground and left to go back home. Within the next few days, my sister repeatedly called to berate me and yelled at me for not getting them something else. Then after a week, my sister called to ask if I was getting my nephews anything better because they were so disappointed and upset. I told her no. She yelled at me some more. Before she hung up, she asked when I was going to bring over the books again or if she needed to come get them. I told her no and that I was keeping them because she and my nephews were being ungrateful and entitled. I told her that she should teach her kids better, not to be spoiled brats, and to be appreciative of any gift that someone gives them, regardless of if they like it or not. Like I said, I enjoyed these books as a kid and would love to reread them as much as I can. So I decided to keep them for myself because my nephews didn't want them to begin with and were being entitled brats. So, am I the jerk for keeping the kids' books I bought for my nephews? Edit. My sister has raised my nephews to be spoiled rotten. If they don't get their way, they will be little monsters to you or others, and my sister encourages their selfishness and bad behavior. One of the reasons I am low contact with her right now. For the people that are asking for my nephew's ages, one is 7 years old and the other is 2 years old. I mostly got the books for the 7 year old, but thought maybe he or my sister could read them to the 2 year old, like bonding time or something. And yes, both play video games. My sister bought each a small handheld kid iPad or whatever it's called, I'm not sure. I didn't even know that such a thing existed until my nephews were a little over 1 year old. They both were taught how to use them, as well as YouTube, kids' TV channels, and Game Boys. I've ranted about kids using technology in another sub before. When I was a kid, we played outside. My 7 year old nephew knew how to use basic internet slash computers at the age of 2. Now my 2 year old nephew does as well. I believe today's parents rely way too heavily on technology to entertain slash keep their kids busy. But that's just my opinion based on my experience with my nephews.
Well, what would you do in this situation? Would you give them the books after all or not? Please let us know.
I would cut all contact with them. People who act like that decrease your quality of life.
Revenge of the construction workers. I'm a teacher, and when I was younger, I would take summer jobs to supplement my income. One summer, I worked for a bricklayer named Jerry and heard an amazing story. I worked for Jerry in the mid-90s, so this story either happened in the early 90s or in the 80s. Here goes. The setting for the story was a community of small rural towns which had only one brick contractor. Jerry began his career as a bricklayer working for this contractor, a real jerk. Jerk and Jerk's son, adult working the business with his father, would harass, belittle, and humiliate all of their employees on a regular basis. No work was ever good enough, and employees were told they weren't worth what they were paid. Not only did Jerk mistreat his employees, but he was equally rude to other subcontractors and to the general contractors who hired him. Since he was the only bricklayer in the community, there was nothing anyone could do about it. Needless to say, the turnover rate for the brick business was very high. The only person that stuck with Jerk and company was Jerry. Jerry told me that his father had instilled a self-confidence in him that Jerry could do anything he set his mind to do, and that he should not evaluate himself according to what others said, but rather by the facts. Although Jerry was belittled by Jerk and his son, as were all of the other employees, Jerry was becoming a very good bricklayer. Jerry knew he was good. Jerk knew Jerry was good. But Jerk didn't know that Jerry knew he was good. Not only was Jerry a good bricklayer, he was very respectful to the boss who disrespected him. Jerk thought that Jerry was a naive pushover who was buying his head games. That would prove to be a huge mistake on his part. One day, Jerry was doing an exceptionally good job at laying bricks. Not only was his craftsmanship amazing, he was laying brick at a high rate of speed so that he was making his boss lots of money. Of course, Jerk and son were belittling his work as though he was doing the very opposite. This scenario was being observed by the general contractor of the project. After work that day, the general contractor asked Jerry to stay behind so he could talk to him. As did every other construction worker in the community, general contractor hated working with Jerk. General contractor told Jerry that he had heard Jerk and son belittling him and told him that he disagreed with everything Jerk was saying. He asked Jerry if he had ever considered going into business for himself. Jerry said that he would like to do that someday. General contractor then said that he would loan Jerry the money to buy a mixer, the most expensive piece of equipment needed to start a brick business, if Jerry would indeed start said business. The only hitch was that Jerry would need to pay for the mixer whenever he could, and that he would subcontract under general contractor. Jerry agreed to those terms and prepared to begin his new venture. Jerry respectfully told Jerk and son his plans and gave his notice. The two mocked Jerry ruthlessly and laughed him to scorn. Jerk told Jerry, "You'll be back in 2 months begging to return to your job. You'll never make it as a subcontractor." 2 months later, rather than collapsing as Jerk predicted, Jerry was still in business and going strong. 1 year later, Jerry's business was booming, and a drunk Jerk showed up at Jerry's house and begged him to come back to work with Jerk and son.
"Jerry, you're the best employee I ever had."
Jerry replied, "Why didn't you ever tell me that when I was working for you?" Jerk couldn't answer the question, and Jerry obviously didn't accept the offer for employment. 2 years after beginning his entrepreneurial adventure, Jerry heard that Jerk and son went out of business. Jerry said that he never intended to harm Jerk and son when he accepted general contractor's offer. He said that looking back on things, he realized that he had become Jerk's greatest nightmare. I can't say that general contractor intended no harm. I thought the most amazing thing about this story was how Jerry maintained his self-esteem in spite of all the ridicule. I also gained a respect for Jerry's father, who instilled an unshakable self-confidence in Jerry. Edit: I contacted Jerry today, after 20 years, to let him know how highly you thought of him. He reminded me that his father was wheelchair-bound and accomplished so much in spite of his handicap. It was his father's overcoming huge obstacles that made Jerk's words seem to be such a minor obstacle to overcome. Have you ever had a boss talk down to you? If so, what did you do about it? Please let us know.
I've got a co-host who talks down to me.
Am I the jerk for not babysitting for my sister-in-law anymore after she called the police on me? My sister-in-law and I have an agreement. She watches my kids 3 days a week, and I watch hers 3 days a week. This agreement has stood since March of 2020 without issues. Any changes have been discussed weeks in advance. A couple of weeks ago, we had an argument. The next day, I brought my kids to her house,
dropped them off, and left. I didn't speak to my sister-in-law because when one of us is in a rush, like I was, it's standard for us to just let the kids out, stay in the car, and drive off when you see the door open. I drove to work, about 40 minutes away. When I got there, I had about 20 missed calls and even more texts, all from my sister-in-law, all saying she didn't want to watch the kids given our argument. Her first text arrived a little before I got to her place, but I didn't see it until I got to work because my phone is always on silent when I drive. I rang her, said I'll arrange to work from home, then come get the kids. She said I have 45 minutes to get back to her place or she would call the police. I told my supervisor the situation and she said I could leave after I did a few things. This delayed me 20 minutes. When I got back to my sister-in-law's, just over an hour later, she said she had already called the police when the 45 minutes ran out. I then had to stick around long enough to tell the officer that I didn't abandon them. There was just a communication issue. Sister-in-law and I had another shouting match later over this. I arranged other childcare for my kids, and I've been mostly ignoring her since. However, she reached out and apologized, and asked if I'd be willing to go back to the old arrangement. I told her to go buzz off. Having something like this on my record, I would never be able to work in my field again, which she knew, and her calling the police was a massive overreaction. So if she needs a babysitter, she can go whistle for all I care. She said that if I checked my phone, talked to her that morning, or came back when I was supposed to, she would not have needed to call the police. And I did this to myself, as she gave me a warning with that first text, and I could have checked my phone or spoken to her directly when I got to her place. All of which she says she would have done if she were in my position, given that we had argued the night before. I've told her that if she thinks I'm babysitting for her, she's delusional and she's on her own. Because of my refusal, it's looking like she may have to quit her job because my brother and her would pay more for a babysitter than they would earn from her working. My mother and brother have both called me a jerk because there were no consequences to her calling the police and that while she overreacted, she's apologized. So if I really forgive her, I'll let us move on. This income loss would also mean that she, my brother, and my niece and nephew might need to move somewhere cheaper, that my brother might have to take on extra hours at work, and in an extreme scenario, they may even be completely unable to live independently, meaning they'd have to move in with her parents, who live several hours away. Am I the jerk? Well, who do you think is the jerk? OP or her sister-in-law? Please let us know.
The best thing you can do with Karens is cut them out of your life, sister-in-law or not. She made her bed, now she gets to lie in it.
No, lady, not mall cop, actual cop. In a former life, a few years ago now, I was a police officer here in good old England. I moved from a team dealing with action-packed 999 calls, speeding around in old Ford Focuses, and dealing with interesting things, to working in a team that supported a large shopping complex. Shoplifting, antisocial behavior, real hard-hitting stuff. The uniform was a white shirt, black tie, and if I was out and about, a vest over the top, with one of the big pointy hats too. If I was on a break though, I'd just put my normal jacket on to cover my shoulder numbers. This was mainly for personal security, so to a casual observer, I was just a bloke in a white shirt with a black tie. Cue the moment. I'd just finished dealing with the paperwork from a shoplifting incident and had a hankering for a sandwich. I locked my vest and hat away, but left my belt of tools, can of spray, cuffs, and metal stick, England again, on. I popped a plain brown jacket over the top and ventured into the shopping complex in search of a footlong. Sandwich specified and acquired, I paid the well-known outlet and ambled to a seating area to mind my own business and chow down. Probably no less than 5 minutes later, I clock a woman, the usual type, attempting to buy a sandwich. Now, from her big arm gestures, I skillfully deduced she wasn't happy. That's not a crime, so back to my sandwich I went. Until, of course, the voices became raised and a hand was slammed on the counter. I tucked the remnants of my sandwich in the bin and ambled over to see what the commotion was. Now, working in the team I did, I was a known face in the center, and I enjoy a long sandwich, so the staff knew me and my job, so they relaxed a little, which really irritated the woman. I quickly realized they didn't have the filling she wanted and she was refusing to take a no for an answer. Me, is everything all right here? The woman turns around and eyes me over. Now, I'm in my early 20s at the time, so she mistakes me for a security guard. Karen,
for goodness sake, I don't need security. This little jerk won't make me my sandwich.
Me, okay, firstly, watch your language. Secondly, I'm a level up from security. She didn't like this.
Oh, buzz off. I just want my sandwich.
She ignores me and goes back to banging her hand on the desk and gesturing wildly at the teen behind the counter. Me, you need to stop that. She rounds on me again.
I said buzz off. I know the management here, so buzz off back to standing around outside Debenham's or I'll get you sacked.
Me, I don't care. I'm warning you that you need to stop this. It's a public order offense. Karen.
Oh, what? I just want my sandwich. Not some jumped-up plastic policeman interfering. Buzz off.
Me. You're causing a scene. Stop hitting the counter or you'll be arrested.
Don't tell me what to do. What, do you think you're Billy Big Boy? Just a wannabe cop. You can't arrest me. Get me your boss now, too.
She was slamming her palms on the sneeze guard with each word, and I think I had been patient enough at that point, so I unzip my jacket to reveal I am in fact a uniformed police constable. Her eyes widen as she sees the cuffs on my belt. Me. Nope, I'm arresting you under Section 5 of the Public Order Act. The arrest is necessary to prevent injury to others and damage to property. You don't have to say anything, but it may harm your defense, etc. Now, I had no intention of cuffing her. I was twice her size, so not necessary. Instead, I steered her, spluttering, to a table and set her down as I called for a car to pick us up. After another 30 minutes of her refusing to believe she'd done anything wrong, I eventually gave her a penalty notice to dispose of the matter. So her non-sandwich fest ended up costing her £80 instead. Speaking of sandwiches, what's your favorite kind of sandwich of all time? Please let us know.
Sweet onion chicken teriyaki all day.
Am I the jerk for breaking a lease, even though I knew it would leave everyone else unable to pay the full rent? I, 21, female, made the incredibly stupid, in hindsight, decision to move in with my high school friends about 4 months ago. Prior to that, I lived interstate to do an apprenticeship. I moved back to my home city to pursue a university degree, now that I'm a qualified electrician, and the only people I knew were people I knew from 4 years ago in high school, who happened to need a fourth person to go on a lease. It was a nightmare. For starters, they gave me the smallest room and yet expected me to pay more rent because I had a well-paying job. I'm working part-time for an electrical company, as one of their employees went part-time due to having a baby, and I am also in full-time uni. They never cooked or cleaned, in spite of eating whatever I made, so I would bulk cook for a week and find most of it gone. They also agreed we should all just get milk and bread for the house, but it was only me. On top of that, I was the only one with a license and car, kind of essential in my line of work, so they'd throw a fit if I didn't give them lift places. So by the end, I was cooking, cleaning, driving people places, living in the smallest room, and paying more than anyone else for food and rent. So I left. There is a penalty for breaking a lease, but anything was worth paying to get out of there. I knew they'd get angry, so I did the preparation on the down low, got another place lined up, by myself thankfully, and lined up a couple of workmates to help me move everything out. I told them everything 2 weeks before I scheduled the move, and they tried to talk me out of it. They kind of dropped it until my mates rocked up in the morning of the move with the van, at which point they lost it. They said they hadn't thought I was serious and I couldn't do this to them, and they've basically been calling me every name under the sun and dragging me online. Am I the jerk for leaving them in this predicament? The furniture is mine, but I still feel kind of guilty. ETA. They're all on my home country's equivalent to benefits while they study full-time. One also works part-time in a cafe. My best friend acts like an entitled spoiled brat and the friendship is so one-sided, I'm ready to call it quits. So my friend and I are both 22 years old. We've been best friends since 2011. We both still live at home. My friend has only ever had one job but got fired. So she sits at home all the time and begs me to do stuff with her. I work full-time at a grocery store. She expects me on my weekends off to hang out with her and goes crazy when I don't. I have a boyfriend and other priorities to cater to, which she doesn't seem to understand. My friend has always been pretty spoiled by her parents, so for me, I pay my parents for monthly rent, phone bill, car insurance, etc., which my friend thinks is weird and makes fun of me for it. When my friend worked, she didn't have to pay her parents for any of that. My friend also likes to brag about blowing her stimulus checks on new clothes, childhood toys, or new electronics, none of which she needs. Her parents pay for everything, and they also don't make her do chores either, which I find odd, but okay. But the thing is, she brags about this all the time, like it's some flex. When we hang out, there have been numerous times where she forgot her money, and I ended up having to pay for her because I didn't want to listen to her scream at me. She never paid me back. I've gone to concerts of singers she likes with her, but if it's someone I like and that she hates, she won't go. We always have to do what she wants to do, or she ruins it if it's something I want to do by acting moody and like a jerk. She flips like a light switch. If you say something she doesn't like, or she takes it the wrong way, she gets all upset and ends up blowing up or giving the silent treatment. She acts like a toddler. She gets jealous when I hang out with my boyfriend or even text him when I'm hanging out with her. She yells at me for talking to him. However, when she has a guy, she non-stop talks about him. If I tell her I'm uncomfortable, she tells me to grow up and it's normal. She also loves to self-deprecate, but project that onto me, and then say she was just joking when I get offended and that I'm being sensitive. On the last vacation I took with just her, it was a nightmare. It had to be her way and what she wanted to do the entire week, or she yelled and walked away from me and won't answer calls or texts. In the hotel room, we went to bed when she wanted to go to bed or wake up when she wants to. I went along with it because I didn't feel like getting into a fight, but boy was I miserable, and I was so happy when it was over. Although she made us miss our flights back, and my parents had to pay for new ones, because hers couldn't. I don't think she even asked. My parents aren't exactly fond of her and tell me she needs to grow up and that they can't wait for the day her parents kick her out, although I don't see that happening. They ask me why I'm still friends with her. They think she is selfish and uses me. I think I feel bad for her because she has no other friends, which is why I stay in this friendship, but I've had it. She's too exhausting to deal with anymore. She's gotten worse. It's not my fault she has nobody else except her parents. It's her fault. I need to stop feeling bad for her. It's like she uses me as a verbal punching bag and a personal chauffeur. My boyfriend thinks she's toxic as heck. Ugh, I can't take it anymore. Well, what would you do in this situation? Would you stay friends with this person or cut them out of your life? Please let us know.
If you have someone like this in your life, cut them out as soon as possible. You won't regret it.
My boss fired me and is my new boss the very next day. Might sound crazy, but it's true. I've been working at a cheap American restaurant for the past 3 years. I was full-time there until last year. I got a second job at a much more upscale, fine dining location, making a ton more money. The newer job is only open in the evenings, so I kept both jobs, working the crappy one in the mornings and the nicer one at night. Over the past 2 years, my morning job has been struggling so hard to find and keep employees due to Hurricane Michael, and then the lockdown happened, and it made it even worse with unemployment and everyone wanting to sit at home and collect that instead of working. And then the GM, at crappy location, got fired for harassment, which was the final straw in that workplace for me. He was the binding glue holding that place together, and then all of a sudden he's gone. The only reason I stayed after that was because it was a second job for me and produced roughly $300 to $400 a week for me working lunches, but mainly for the front of house manager. She's a good old-time friend of mine, and I felt obligated to stay there for her sake. So my evening job is crazy awesome, make tons of money, fun place to work at. They got all their crap together. The kitchen is beast mode, just an overall great work environment and pay. And everyone for my morning job knows it too. Over the past month, working at the crappy diner spot and all of the chaos and stress that came with it that has only been getting worse for everyone, I had some people mention to me if my other location was hiring. People always would ask me about my evening job and if they're hiring, but I would always shut it down because no way I would bring said unexperienced person to my other job, just based on their experience and things I witnessed personally coming from them. But my evening job, for whatever reason, had a ton of openings. Servers, bussers, food runners, bar backs, and even a GM and assistant manager. Both ours retired within 2 weeks of each other recently within short notice. So all of a sudden, my better job needs people, and they set up a referral program. If I refer someone and they stay for 60 days, I get $100. And if they stay for 120 days, I get another $100. I started responding differently to my morning coworkers inquiring about jobs. I had 3 people approach me, a server, a host, essentially morning jobs busboy, and even my friend who is the front of house manager, asking if we were hiring. All 3 of these people are super awesome and would fit perfectly at my evening job. So I told them to apply and tell them that I referred them. They all got interviews and have all been hired. They all approached me. I never went to tell them about it. My manager friend hasn't technically been hired yet, but has gone to the evening spot for an observation shift. She also hasn't let the morning job know about it either, but they absolutely do know the other 2 employees up and left, and they found out that they went to my evening job. The final straw for my morning job was when I went and approached the one and only person that I asked if they wanted a better job, everyone else came to me. He's a hardworking cook, and the evening location could use him. So I told him, and he interviewed and got the job. When he went into the morning spot and told them he was going to start working at a new spot, and they found out where, the kitchen manager was livid and removed me from the schedule. I got a call from my manager friend, the one getting hired as well, to inform me of all of this. The insane part is how awkward it'll be for her when she puts in her 2 weeks' notice. She called me 2 days ago to tell me all of this. She essentially told me I was fired for scalping their employees, per the kitchen manager's request. She knew I didn't give a crap and would be fine without the job. I laughed and said, "So, are you firing me?" To which she replied, "Yes." I then smirked and giggled and replied, "Okay, well, I'll see you tomorrow night." Last night was her first night, as well as the new cook I got hired, and my other two friends I got jobs were there as well. It was a nice feeling to see them all actually happy and excited to be at work and actually making some money. Sorry for this post being so lengthy. My house in the middle of the street. When I pay my mortgage, I round up and divide in half. I pay half every other week, so my mortgage got picked up by another company when my mortgage company went out of business. To do what I was doing with a new company was $300 to enroll and an extra $40 each payment. Oh, heck no. I spoke to my credit union and they had an auto pay that would pay my bills from my direct deposit free. So nearly a year goes by and I get one of those scary letters. "You are in default on your mortgage. Unless we get X payment within 10 days of this letter, we will foreclose." I was astounded since I had never missed a payment and was actually paid a couple of months ahead. I spoke with their accounting department. It seems they couldn't accept half payments, only full payments, even though they had done so for a year. So the money had to sit unapplied until a full payment was accrued. That made sense, except again, they got more than enough, and it was always in there in full before the due date, so on the due date, they should have just taken it and applied it to the mortgage. So further digging, the rep says to me, "Oh, by the way, we have $8,200 of unapplied funds in this account. What do you want to do with it?" Pay my mortgage with it? "Oh, we can't do that." So I had to get a check cut for $8,200, pay $45 for them to overnight it to me, take it to my credit union, cash it, pay $25 for a cashier's check, and pay another $45 to send the cashier's check back to them. I called relentlessly to see when it had arrived and had all kinds of postal tracking, signature confirmations, etc. Remember, I only had 10 days to get this done. So if they get it and verify that it's applied to my mortgage, then there will be no foreclosure. The rep tells me, "Well, your next payment is due in 2 weeks, and there will be penalties and late fees applied, so the amount is XYZ, and we are raising your interest rate to nearly twice what it was before." No, all this is your company's fault. She says, "You knew these were the terms and conditions when you took out your mortgage with us." No, I didn't take it out with you. I took it out with another company and I was assigned to your company. "Well, don't be late with your next payment." No, I want to speak with a manager. So I finally get to speak to a manager and he wasn't much better. His only response was, "Well, you can always go with another company, but good luck with that these days. So many foreclosures and your credit is not very good for missing so many payments." So I decided to take his advice. I contacted my credit union, explained everything, showed them their own payment transfers and the mortgage statements showing the other company had received the money bi-weekly like clockwork, and the credit union took over my mortgage. I got a reduced interest rate and got rid of all the fees and penalties and got the overpayment back. I applied it to the new mortgage payments, etc. So when a company acts like they have you over a barrel and tells you to try to go with someone else, do it. Edit. This still astounds me even after all these years. I can't imagine any other company, car loan, credit card company, etc., asking, "Hey, what do you want us to do with all this money sitting over here?" And not automatically concluding, "Oh yeah, let's apply it to the outstanding balance." Am I the jerk for telling a coworker to find something to do on break that doesn't involve annoying me? Sometimes a shift has so little to do that we take longer and more frequent breaks than we normally would. When I suspect this might be the case, I shove some needlework into my bag to occupy my hands so I'm not constantly grazing. I'll claim a table or part of one, stick my headphones in to show I don't want to be distracted, and start stitching. One of my recent coworkers was amused by this. I'm not much of a girly girl, so seeing me do a traditionally feminine activity wasn't what he expected, and he assumed that my music would be similarly stereotypical, and he kept coming over to bug me, forcing me to pause my stitching and my music to answer him. He wouldn't get the hint that I really just wanted to be in my own head for a bit instead of being forced to socialize. One time I was deep into my music and didn't see him coming from behind me, so he took it on himself to pause it for me by reaching over me and picking up my phone to pause Spotify from the lock screen. And that's when he realized what I was listening to. A power metal band called Gloryhammer. They are definitely not stereotypically feminine. Even if their keyboardist slash antagonist does rock a dress and have a magical girl transformation in two videos for his other band. And he starts laughing and saying that I am disrespecting metal by stitching while listening to it. Seriously? I was not happy. I was already getting a bit upset by the constant interruptions to my flow, and then someone I barely know goes and picks up my phone just to force me to pay attention to him? Nuh-uh. I laid into him verbally after snatching my phone back. The culmination of my rant was that he should find something to do on these long breaks that doesn't involve interacting with me in any way at all, because he's done nothing but annoy me. I then stuck my headphones back in, moved my stuff to a seat with my back to a wall, and went back to stitching. He's glared at me on every shift I've had with him since, and he's spread it that I'm a bad-tempered, antisocial jerk who hates him. Am I the jerk for telling this guy off instead of trying to continue deflecting him politely? Karen thinks she owns my house. Characters. We've got entitled mother, we've got entitled kid, we've got me and my girlfriend. Background. I live in a rather quiet apartment building, but as soon as this crazy jerk moved here, I knew that my situation was going to blow up. I always try my best to be kind to my neighbors, and it wasn't any different for entitled mom. I enjoy having small get-togethers in my apartment with a couple of my neighbors, so when entitled mom and her annoying-as-heck kid moved into the building, I decided to invite them to a weekly Friday adults game night. Don't judge, this was all before lockdown. The party was set to begin at 7, but entitled mom came a good hour late. Our parties are for adults because we have lots of drinks and some other things. Entitled mom decides to ignore the clear as day rule that kids aren't allowed, and she decides to bring her little jerk to my house. As soon as I see the kid, I tell her, no kids allowed. But then she goes and says, it's okay, he has my permission. I sigh and ask her to come back in 10 minutes. Now me and the neighbors have to clear all of our stuff and pack them in the cupboards. She and her little jerk come back in 30 minutes and immediately start eating all of my food. I'm a really non-confrontational person, so telling them to stop was a big no-no. This isn't even the real story yet. It's just some background to explain the crap show that's about to happen. The story. Lockdown happened. Girlfriend was staying at my place during lockdown because her parents both have pre-existing conditions. We went through the whole process. So one day, I was out of the house getting groceries when girlfriend called me crying and saying she didn't feel safe in our apartment. Apparently, girlfriend was taking a shower when she heard someone. She thought it was me and she opened the curtain to see entitled kid, that little jerk, standing outside the bathroom door. She screamed and slapped him and kicked him out. Hearing this, I immediately rushed home to comfort her, having absolutely no clue how that little jerk got into my home. As soon as I got home, I see entitled mom standing outside my apartment, banging on the door, without a mask. I tap her on the shoulder and start to explain to her that she really needs to control her kid. I tried to be as nice as possible, even though I was seething with anger. I tried to tell her that I understand he's going through changes, but breaking into people's houses and doing things like this wasn't okay at all. Before I could finish, entitled mom goes off on me. She starts screaming at me that her son didn't break into anyone's house and that girlfriend had no right to hit him. She said she was going to call the cops and tell them that we assaulted the little jerk. Even though at this point I'm literally about to get her, I try my best to remain calm and ask her how her mistake of a son got into my house. The entitled mother starts screaming at me, and in her anger, she lets it slip that during my neighbor's meeting, in the background section, she took one of my apartment's keys. My brain just shuts off. Girlfriend comes out hearing the commotion and apparently heard that entitled mom stole my keys. Girlfriend goes off. She says she's calling the cops for stealing, breaking and entering, an invasion of privacy. At this point, my brain is still processing what entitled mom just said. Entitled mom screams back that in her rental agreement, she was given access to all the amenities of the apartment and she somehow believed that my house belonged to them too. Keep in mind, I own my apartment. Girlfriend and I kept strong on her promise and called the cops right then and there. Entitled mom got arrested, but I don't know what happened from there. All I know is that I changed my locks, got only two new house keys, gave one to my girlfriend and kept it, and bought one of those camera doorbell things. Edit. Wow, guys, thanks for the huge response. I got a lot of questions asking how old Entitled Kid is. I don't know exactly how old he is, but he looked to be about 15 or 16. Edit 2. Holy moly. When I just posted this, I tried to respond to everyone's comments, but now that's getting kind of difficult. I'm going to try to make some broad statements, and I hope it answers your questions. My girlfriend and I are feeling much better. I showed her the post, and we went over a couple of the responses together. I have no clue what's wrong with the kid. He might be a little mentally unstable, but other than that, I have no clue why he acted like he did. Also, I want to take a moment to thank you guys for all of the updates, the Wholesome Award, the Silver Award, and the Hugs Award. Thank you guys for all the help you offered, and I hope I answer some of your questions. Thanks for being so kind. This is my first time making a single post, so I was kind of worried I was going to get trashed on for not handling the situation properly or something. But you guys have been nothing but kind. Have you ever had a neighbor who just loved to overstep boundaries? If so, what did they do? Please let us know. I've got a co-host who does, I tell you that much. My cheating ex-wife, Karen, now has to pay me child support. Grab a cup of coffee or tea, because this is a long story. I apologize, but I hope it's worth your time to read. My revenge began with discovering my wife's infidelity. Let's call her Carrie. After 14 years of marriage and 3 kids, I saw a text appear on her work phone for just a few seconds that would forever change my life. It was a message that had no business being on anyone's work phone. It was on the lock screen, and the sender's name was visible. Let's call him Perry. Background: I married Carrie when I was 25 and she was 22. I was teaching high school at the time, and she was an RN. After having our first kid, Carrie became a stay-at-home mom. Money was tight, so I took on an admin role in my department and coached 2 sports for the stipends. We made it, and after a few annual pay raises, I stopped coaching and took advantage of a program to earn an administrative credential. Once I made the jump to administration, our last kid was ready for preschool, and Carrie decided she wanted to go back to work. Nursing jobs are always available, but they're not always the best positions. Carrie pretty much had to start back at the bottom, working alongside nurses that were a lot younger than she was, and could work back-to-back double shifts that took a toll on Carrie. When she asked her supervisor about other positions, she was told that without a BSN, she wasn't going to move up. At the time, Carrie had only the 2-year ADN. I told her that between preschool, after-school rec, and my retired mother, who was always willing to pick up the kids from school and watch them, I'd support her getting her BSN. It took her 3 years, but eventually she had her BSN and was promoted to a better position at the hospital. Things were good for a while. We had plenty of money, so finally moved into our own McMansion, bought a new car, etc. I'd moved from school admin to the district admin, so I had more time to spend with Carrie and the kids. She was working a more predictable schedule, and even with my often long hours at work, this change allowed us to finally take vacations to all the places we had put on a list during our honeymoon. She kept that list in our wedding album. At some point, years later, I noticed she was carrying 2 phones with her. When I asked her about it, she said that it was a phone provided by the hospital. I didn't question her explanation because my district had also given me the option of a phone or a phone stipend, which I took instead. Again, months went by and I thought we were a happy, perfect family. I charged my phone in our den while she charged her phones in our guest bedroom that doubled as a computer room, so we could keep tabs on the kids while they surfed the web. I was updating software on the computer when I saw a light around her work phone. She had a habit of always turning her phones face down when charging them. Out of curiosity, I reached over to the phone and flipped it over. A message had popped up on the lock screen asking her when she'd like to hook up again. I also saw that Perry sent it. The world stopped around me. I just froze. My first thoughts were, what the heck was that about? It's her work phone. That kind of message gets people fired. Then it hit me. Was Carrie cheating on me? It's amazing how the brain works. I suddenly started remembering a lot of things Carrie had done that seemed odd, but I'd either dismissed them myself or immediately accepted her explanation. She was always working out of the room to answer a call or return a text and claimed that it would violate HIPAA if I overheard her talking about a patient. I accepted this because education has similar privacy laws regarding students. She would sometimes come home with the faint smell of cologne on her clothes and claimed it was from helping to move male patients. Again, I accepted this at face value, but it always struck me as odd how it seemed to be the same scent of cologne. Once the proverbial barn door was open, I started seeing a lot of things that I'd missed before. Our love life had cooled off considerably, which wasn't helped by her having to leave the house at odd hours to fill in for other nurses that called in sick. I also recalled where I'd seen the name Perry before, and a call to the hospital confirmed he was a doctor there. For the next week or so, I was walking around in a daze trying to put all of the pieces together. One of our kids had left a book in Carrie's car, so it was an excuse to visit the hospital. Carrie had told me personal visits were frowned upon. My kid went up to get Carrie's car key. I had forgotten my key to her car at home. I talked to a nurse in the lobby and joked about how work phones seem like a blessing, but all they do is put you on call 24 hours a day. This led to her eventually telling me that the hospital was too cheap to give cell phones to nurses, so only high-level executives got them, which didn't include Carrie. With pretty much everything confirmed, I took some personal time off the next day to talk to a divorce lawyer. The news she gave me was horrible. We lived in a community property state with no-fault divorce. I made more money than Carrie. She had been the primary caretaker of the kids, and we'd been married for more than 10 years. Basically, if I filed for divorce, I'd be done for. Lose the house, pay alimony, she'd get a huge chunk of my retirement, and I'd pay child support for the next decade, unless I was lucky enough to be awarded joint custody. The worst thing she told me was that it didn't matter that she cheated. It didn't matter. I was crushed. There was only one person I could trust with this kind of information. She was a fellow teacher that had also made the jump to administration, but was stuck at a school site. Let's call her Anne. Anne had been married at 19, but her marriage was annulled when he got some other woman pregnant. Since then, she had focused on her career, and we had found we were kindred spirits in a lot of ways regarding K-12 education. I talked to Anne. She said something to me that changed my whole mindset. If you don't like the hand you're dealt, change the deck. I realized I had two problems. I made more money than Carrie, and she had more time than me to be the primary caretaker of the kids. The second issue was actually kind of easy. At every district office, there are jobs that are fast tracks to higher positions, and there are jobs that administrators suffer through, like mess or KP duty in the military. One of these dead-end regulatory positions was open again. Ambitious administrators leave after a couple of years when a better position opens up. I sat down with our district superintendent and asked about being transferred to that position. At first, he was shocked, but I told him that it was my time to take one for the team, and it would fill a hole in my admin experience. He agreed. It was really just crunching numbers with no personal or student interaction, so I could set my schedule, even take a laptop home and work there. With my new free time, I began taking the kids to school, picking them up from school, not leaving them in after-school rec or having my mother watch them, and taking them home. I'd help them with their homework, make dinner, etc. While the end goal was to become their primary caretaker, I can't explain how much I really, really enjoyed taking a more active role in their day-to-day lives. My salary hadn't been reduced, so I needed to find a way for Carrie to make a lot more money than she was in current nursing position. I remembered Carrie being mad after she had earned her BSN, and a supervisor told her, "In the future, bachelor degrees will be worthless, and everyone will need at least a master's degree." Carrie had worked hard to get her BSN, and that supervisor's comment really upset her. I talked her into starting an MSN program. I told her that since I had a much more flexible work schedule, I would keep taking care of the kids. She was reluctant at first. Then I said, "You could have every evening free to study or go to class, whatever you want to do." I saw her eyes immediately light up, probably thinking that she could spend more time with Perry. To make sure she was actually completing her MSN courses, I paid her tuition and fees directly to her university. It was going to take her between 2 and 3 years to finish. Those years were rough at times. I could tell every time she was rushing off or coming back from seeing Perry. There was an excitement or sense of satisfaction in her eyes that just wasn't there when she was doing her coursework. I had to either smile or pretend I didn't notice. My temper got short at times, and I found myself in arguments over petty nonsense. A couple of times, I almost blew the whole charade, having to bite my tongue and apologize rather than scream insults at her that she deserved. Anne remained my confidant through all of this. I'd recommended her for my previous fast-track position, and she joined me at the district office. Anne was qualified, hardworking, ambitious, and only needed her foot in the door to impress the higher-ups. I even got a few pats on the back for recommending her after she'd impressed everyone. Anne and I started having our own affair. It wasn't some hot-blooded, passionate romance, but two friends giving each other what they need. Without Anne, I wouldn't have been able to maintain the charade of being oblivious. But when Carrie would come home smiling after spending time with Perry, I was able to hear it, smiling back because I had my own lover. About 3.5 years later, Carrie completed her MSN and was promoted at the hospital. Her salary went up substantially and was now higher than mine. When the kids and I made her a congratulations dinner, I made a joke about her being the breadwinner for the family, and she laughed, joking back, I should be a stay-at-home dad now. A month later, I went back to the lawyer, who didn't remember me at first, and told her the financial situation had drastically changed. With these new facts, she drafted the petition and filed it. When the kids were with my mother, I had Carrie served. The deputy knocked on our front door, and I let him in, pointing at my wife. He asked her name and then handed her a copy of the divorce petition. With the deputy standing there, I told Carrie I knew all about the affair with Perry, but I didn't tell her how long I'd known. I told her to go be happy with her doctor lover. She screamed at me, tried to lie, and then made the mistake of rushing toward me. The deputy stopped her and warned her that she would go to jail for violence too. He suggested she pack a bag to stay somewhere else. Carrie left after I promised not to tell the kids about what she was doing. I didn't tell the kids, but I told my mother, who told my sister, who told her kids, who told their cousins, my kids. It took a few days, but eventually the kids knew that Dad was divorcing Mom because she had a boyfriend. In the end, the court granted the divorce, giving me primary custody of our kids because I was already their primary caretaker. I kept the house with a promise I'd refinance to buy out Carrie's half. She was ordered to pay child support, and I used that fact to negotiate with her to give up any rights to my retirement if I bought her out. I was able to refinance my home. It was the era when banks threw money at everyone to buy or refinance a mortgage, and with a little money borrowed from my parents, I bought out Carrie's community property interest in the home and in my retirement. The day she signed all of the paperwork with my lawyer, finally ending any possible financial obligations to her, was the happiest I had been. I felt like I could finally breathe. I celebrated with Anne, who'd been my rock through all of it. I'm not ashamed to say that through the years, I'd cried many times in her arms. Anne and I would eventually marry. She got promoted to a higher position, and I was convinced to take back my previous position at the district when my youngest reached high school. Carrie and I got along well after the divorce. We took the kids to family therapy and worked out this co-parenting thing. For the first few months, the kids kept asking her why she needed a boyfriend when Daddy was there all along. Between the kids and the therapist raking her over the coals, I don't have anything to say at all. Carrie missed a lot of time with the kids because of her now legitimately busy work schedule, and I actually felt bad that my kids were missing time with their mother, so encouraged them to talk to her on the phone instead. When Carrie found out that I'd proposed to Anne, she congratulated me. I told her it's okay for her to marry Perry too. She got sad. She told me that Perry had started seeing another woman, a younger nurse at the hospital, because with her new promotion, she didn't have time for him, and when they did get together, she wasn't fun anymore. My ex-wife, the woman who cheated on me and destroyed our marriage, was looking to me for sympathy. I had none to give. What I had was years of anger and frustration, years of knowing that some other man had been with my wife. I'd lost weight from not being able to eat. I'd suffered hypertension and had to confide in my doctor why it wasn't the stress of my job. I had to listen to my dentist complain about how I was grinding and listen to him tell me that I needed dental implants if I kept it up. There were times where I had to be intimate with Carrie to keep up the charade, fortunately infrequently. But in the end, it was all worth it. Sure, Carrie got a big payout when I bought her out of the house in my retirement, which she was trickling back to me through child support, but she lost everything else. Her kids only saw her every other weekend and spent a couple of holidays with her. Perry dumped her, and he was no great catch anyway, since he was twice divorced with 5 kids and paying alimony and child support through the nose. I kept my kids, my house, my income, my retirement, I got Anne, and I am genuinely happy. All in a community property state with no fault divorce. If that's not pro-revenge, then I don't know what is. Entitled kid got away with everything because his mom was our teacher. Cast. We've got entitled kid. We've got me, the antisocial nerd. We've got teacher, entitled kid's mother. I don't have it in me to call her entitled mom or Karen because she was always so nice to me. We've got my dad, and we've got vice principal. I first met entitled kid in kindergarten. We became close friends and had many playdates. His attitude started to change in second grade. He would say horrible things to me just to look cool in front of the other kids. It started off as just some mean nicknames, but then he would point out flaws about my body to his friends while I was nearby. Third grade was a little easier since we were put into different classes, but whenever he came over to my house, he would break and ruin my toys, delete save files from my video games, and try to get me in trouble with my parents. I asked my dad to stop inviting him multiple times, but this is pretty much how the conversation would end up. My dad: teacher and her husband were busy and asked me to babysit. I couldn't say no. Me: can you at least get him to stop deleting stuff from my DS? I worked hard decorating the lands in my My Sims Kingdom game.
He's your guest, so you have to let him play on your DS. I don't want to hear any more complaints.
It got to a point where I would just let him play LEGO Star Wars alone while I would play Webkinz on my parents' computer so that I wouldn't have to interact with him. At least my complaints weren't entirely ignored, since my parents tried to get me a different teacher for 4th and 5th grade. Students at my school would always have the same teacher during those 2 years. Unfortunately, their request was ignored, and I ended up having teacher along with Entitled Kid. Some of the staff at the school not only thought Entitled Kid and I were still friends, but they also thought we would develop some sort of puppy love. My mom told me that one staff member thought what we had was so cute, and she could already hear wedding bells. Keep in mind, we were between 9 and 10 at the time. I never thought of T as a bad person, just a bad teacher. At the beginning of each year, she would give this long speech about how she doesn't give her kids special treatment, but that would turn out to be false. Entitled Kid would even brag about how he's done stuff that should have got him suspended, but his mom would make it so that never happened. During the first half of 4th grade, Entitled Kid and I were literally seated back to back. He took this as an opportunity to get more physical with his bullying. He would hit and steal stuff from my desk, headbutt at the back of my head, pull his chair out to knock me over, and pull on my clothes. And what would teacher say about this?
Entitled Kid, stop it.
That's it. Would he stop? No. Then one day I snapped. We were doing presentations and I was already nervous because I hated public speaking. While someone else was presenting, I went over my work in my head. I didn't notice Entitled Kid was pulling my chair back until after the third time I pulled it forward and felt a tug. I saw his hand on the leg of my chair about to pull again. I told him to stop, but he only laughed. As he pulled my chair, I lifted the back of my chair. Then, using all of my weight, I brought it back down on his hand. He screamed. Teacher:
Entitled Kid, we are in the middle of presentations.
Entitled Kid:
Mom, she's crushing my hand.
Me: why was your hand down there to begin with?
I was grabbing my pencil.
Me: your pencil's on your desk. I can see it. Teacher:
Enough. Crazy Dorito Queen, get your chair off this hand. Entitled Kid, go to the nurse's office.
I didn't break any of his bones, but there was a circular bruise on his hand for a while. Teacher changed the seating arrangement so that we were both on opposite sides of the classroom. I ended up developing anger issues after this. People started to hate me because how dare I hurt this golden child, but I didn't care. I just wanted them to know that I wasn't going to stay silent anymore. I know this was a small thing to snap over, but between Entitled Kid, adults not listening, and the presentations, I had had it. It didn't end there. Entitled Kid just went back to the same old thing, but I would end up screaming at him. In 5th grade, when he found out I had also signed up to play the trumpet in the school band, he begged me to change instruments, even after I told him my parents already rented one. He tried to continue to bully me in middle school. His mom wasn't there to baby him anymore, so he didn't get away with it easily. As a result, he tried to get me in trouble instead. Vice Principal:
Entitled Kid told me this morning that you hit him yesterday. He also has a witness.
Me: he's just trying to get me in trouble, and his friend is in on it too. He's been doing this since elementary school.
Well, you kids aren't in elementary school anymore. Straighten up, or I will have to give you detention.
Me: but I didn't even do anything. Vice Principal walks away. I told my dad what happened, so he went to talk to the Vice Principal. What really upset me was that he said the exact same things I said, but the Vice Principal actually listened to him. At least I never had a problem with Entitled Kid again after this. The last thing I ever heard about Entitled Kid was during my sophomore year of high school. He went to a performing arts school while I went to the high school in my district. One day, a girl from that school transferred to mine, and one of the first things she told me was how glad she was to get away from this jerk who had been messing with her, and that none of the teachers would do anything about it since they didn't want to risk his future music career. She was shocked when I guessed his name right. Apparently, he became even more of a jerk when he entered high school. He thought he was a better musician than everyone, and he expected girls to just go on dates with him without arguing. I really hope he's matured over the years. Am I the jerk for telling my sister that she is not an adoptive parent? I, 34, female, have 3 kids. 2 are adopted from China. 3 years ago, we got matched, and we decided to announce it to the family at our Christmas party. When we said, "We're adopting," the first words out of my sister, now 32, female, mouth were, "Me too." I was very confused, as she had never seemed interested in adoption, so I asked her what she meant a few minutes later, and she started telling me all about the new corgi she was getting. I was kind of annoyed, because I feel like it's weird to compare the adoption of pets to humans, but I let it go at the time. Fast forward about 7 months when we were home with the girls. They were 4 and 7, and the grieving process was very short and hard. It was just a difficult adjustment in general. When I tried to call my sister, she kept comparing it to her dog, which she had gotten a few months earlier. Like, I would tell her some things that are triggering to my daughters, and she would say, "Oh yeah, Howie had trouble with that on the first few days, but we just kept exposing him to it, and he got used to it." Howie is her dog. First of all, that is terrible advice. And second, she would say it like she was some experienced parent giving advice to a new mother. She has a stepson, but he was 11 when she met him and 13 when she became his stepmom. She has not adopted him, and her husband choose for her not to be a parental figure for him. So I don't really think it's her place to be giving out parenting advice. Well, the last straw was that I go to a Zoom adoptive parents support group, and yesterday we had an event type thing where you could bring in a friend or someone who may be considering adoption and give them a little insight from the parents' point of view. My sister asked me to invite her, as she said she may adopt one day. I did, and when they started talking about how sometimes in orphanages, hygiene isn't taken care of, aka they don't have their teeth taken care of, and often wear the same clothes for multiple days in a row, my sister started talking about how it was similar to how her dog was treated in the shelter and how annoying it was to have to take him to the vet for his teeth because they weren't properly cared for in the shelter. Everyone in the meeting looked very uncomfortable, especially the woman in charge, who is an adoptee. After the meeting, we were talking on the phone, and I tried to tell her nicely that was an inappropriate thing to say when talking about inhumane conditions of actual people, but she accused me of not caring about inhumane conditions of dog shelters. I said, "I do care about that, but it's not the same as kids, and adopting a dog from a shelter is not the same as adopting a kid, and doesn't make you an adoptive parent." She hung up on me and blocked me on Facebook. Did I say something wrong? Am I the jerk here? Edit. I didn't invite her specifically. I reposted the event to my Facebook page, and my sister messaged and asked me to invite her. And this was not a conversation type thing. It was a presentation put on by the group leader slash agency rep. So I didn't think she would have much time to talk. And also, I thought this would help her learn more about actual adoption and how different it is to animal adoption. Edit 2. I do understand what it's like to have a dog and how they're like a baby in some ways. I have 4. But I still would never compare the adoption of my dogs to the adoption of my daughters. Well, who do you agree with? OP or their sister? Please let us know.
I wish I had a corgi.
Am I the jerk because I won't give an employee 6 weeks off to be with his newborn? I'm looking for moral judgment since I know I'm legally in the clear. I'm the GM of a small grocery store. Because of how small our store is and how limited our hours are, we can only afford to keep a staff of 5 plus myself. Dave joined our staff about 4.5 months ago. He's a very quiet man and he does not discuss his life outside of work. He doesn't actually say much at all. All he's really said about himself is that he's new to the area and he's in his early 20s. His performance has been, at best, slightly below average. He has a problem being on time for shifts, and he has a tendency to ask to leave early on days where he's been late. He does the basic bare minimum of his duties. Dave spoke to me yesterday and revealed to me that not only is he married, but his wife is pregnant and her due date is this coming Wednesday. He asked me to give him at least 4 weeks off to be at home with her, but he would prefer I give him 6 weeks. I was shocked because none of us knew he was married, let alone with a kid on the way. I told him I'd review his request and let him know. The rule at this store has always been that time off requests must be given with a minimum 2 weeks notice. I tell new hires this multiple times during the onboarding process, and Dave was informed of this several times. I'm also annoyed because Dave's had 4 months to speak to me about time off, and he waited until literally 4 days before he needed the time off. I work 6 days a week at the store, and I'm always available in person or on the phone. To give Dave his time, I'd have to hire someone to take his place and train them, and to me, that just didn't seem fair to anyone to hire someone for a month to 6 weeks and then let them go. but we just don't have the ability to keep Dave and a new hire and the rest of my staff. Now, we've had staff ask for time off before, and we can handle a 2 or 3 week absence, but 6 weeks is too much to ask of my staff. It isn't fair on them. I spoke to Dave today and told him I couldn't give him the time off he asked for, but that I could give him 2 weeks off. I later offered 3 weeks, and then give him a reduced schedule for as long as he needed so he could still be with his family and make money. Dave was shockingly angry when I denied his request. Like, he was annoyed. He was furious. He began accusing me of being unfair and said that if a woman had asked me for the time off to have a baby, I'd have given it to her. I informed him that when I gave birth to my child, I was only able to take off 3 weeks. And we've only had one other employee take maternity, and she was able to take a month before she told me she'd need the time off with about 5 months of notice. Dave went back to work in a bad mood. Members of staff said he was bad-mouthing me. I'm not going to fire him at this time because I'm sure he's stressed enough as it is. But was I the jerk for not giving him exactly what he wanted? Edit. We're in North Carolina, where we do not have a paid family leave for anyone other than state employees, and in cases where the business offers it. FMLA only qualifies if your business has a certain number of employees, the employee has worked a certain amount of hours in a 12-month period, and the employee gave 30 days notice for the request. The most I have the ability to offer an employee is unpaid leave, but I don't legally have to guarantee employment. That said, I would never take advantage of this law. Well, what do you think? Is OP the jerk, or is Dave? Please let us know.
I'd fire Dave in a heartbeat. The guy sounds like a real piece of work.
Karen's sister-in-law tries to get rid of my cat, so I kick her out. I, male 27, have a cat named Billy. He's my best friend and is very funny and adorable. He always makes me laugh and comforts me when I need him. My fiance, female 26, had her pregnant sister stay with us after her boyfriend kicked her out. This cost me to work more since I pay for everything. My fiance is currently looking for a job, but nothing was found. The problem started when her sister started complaining about Billy. She'd yell at him to get out whenever he's in the kitchen or the living room. She'd spray him with water whenever she wants him out and throw his food away. Once I saw it with my own eyes, I asked her to respect Billy as a resident of my home and to leave him alone. My fiance said her sister never had a cat, so she doesn't know how to treat them, which is nonsense since animals just want to be left alone, but my fiance's sister seemed to be doing it deliberately. Yesterday, I came home at 6 p.m. and Billy wasn't home. I went to look for him after my fiance's sister said he left in the morning. I finally saw my neighbor bringing him to me, saying that my fiance's sister dropped him off near an auto repair shop far from here. I was livid. Billy was too scared, he couldn't even eat. I confronted him, and she lied about not going anywhere and asked my fiance to back her up, but my fiance refused. She then admitted it, but kept excusing what she did by saying that she was just worried for her baby since cats aren't good to be around pregnant women. I blew up at her and told her to leave. My fiance said that that's her sister and her niece slash nephew and I should be more graceful. I argued with her about how Billy felt after what her sister had done, but my fiance called me unsupportive and was overreacting and no harm in taking Billy to stay with a friend since her sister clearly is scared of him. Well, who do you agree with? OP or his fiance and her sister? Please let us know.
OP, you need to kick both of them out immediately. You better not marry her, bruh.
Despite the will, Aunt Karen thinks my parents' property belongs to her. This happened almost 5 years ago, and I just got notice yesterday that my entitled Aunt Karen has passed, and I got a call from her husband asking me to attend the funeral next weekend, and I declined, as did my older brother, Mark, for purposes of this story. Karen was my mother's older sister, and she constantly interfered in my mother and her children's lives. She never liked my father and always tried to tell my mother that she made a mistake by marrying him. She didn't like the name my parents picked out for my older brother, and my great-grandmother passed the day before I was born. And when Karen found out they were going to name me after her, Karen freaked out and said she wanted to name her potential future kid that, so my mother couldn't use it. Then she tried to talk her out of it by saying it's too old-fashioned and kids would make fun of me, which they did, but for other reasons. She criticized both my brothers and my choice of friends and even complained when I started playing softball because proper ladies didn't play sports, and if her daughter ever tried playing a sport, she would have her removed from the team. Spoiler alert, she never had kids. The day after my 16th birthday, my parents drove on a business trip down to California. I live in Idaho. My dad said that when they got back, he would drive me to the DMV to get my license. He never did, because on the drive to California, they hit a patch of ice, spun out, crashed, and passed away. I was a wreck for some time after that. I didn't even want to attend my high school graduation later, because my parents wouldn't be there. Their will split everything evenly between my brother and I. At the funeral, my parents, who owned their own business, production manager, Tim, was talking to my brother, and my brother told him that in a couple weeks, he would step in and take over, and he was counting on Tim to run things smoothly until then, and help him in taking it over and learning the ropes. I had no interest in the business, other than it was a guaranteed summer job when I was growing up, so I stayed out of it and just collected profit checks until I sold my half to Mark, and he continues to run the business to this day. Mark told Tim that he should assure the employees there that their jobs were safe and that no major changes would be made. Then, one day, Aunt Karen showed up and began putting her stuff in my parents' office, and when Tim confronted her about this, she said his services were no longer needed and he was fired. Tim called Mark up, and Mark went down with the family attorney, some police, and the necessary paperwork and had her removed, while she said the place was now hers because it was her sister's, so now she was the owner. As long as I've known her, she's never had a steady job and has had three husbands, not counting the man who called me, never met him, and milked each one as much as she could get until she divorced him. The next day I was leaving for school. I walked, it was fairly close, about 10 minutes, and saw her car and a moving van parked outside. She said she was moving into her house and then said in a sickly sweet voice that for a reasonable rent, she would continue to allow me to stay there until I graduated high school. I went in and called my brother, and he again showed up with a family attorney, police, and all the paperwork and had her removed from the property. I was at school, so I didn't get to see what happened, but that night, Mark gave me a business card for a policeman who I assumed helped deal with all of this and told me that if I ever saw Aunt Karen on or near the property, to call that number and report her immediately. Don't even try to confront her or give her a warning, just call. I do know that the movers charged her to move her stuff into the van, drive across town, get turned away, and drive back across town and move her stuff back into her apartment, which she hadn't given notice yet. I got scared to the point that I didn't like letting our dog into the backyard when I was at school. I used to put her out in the yard to let her play in the fenced backyard while I was in school. For a while, I just put her in the locked and closed garage and then cleaned up her messes when I got home in the afternoon. Eventually, Karen moved to Colorado, where I assume she met and married the man who called me and said that she had passed and he couldn't find anyone from her family to attend the funeral. I chose not to tell him about her and politely said, "Sorry for your loss, but I can't make it." From discussions with Mark, he basically told him the same thing. Outside of myself, Mark, and Mark's infant daughter, I don't think she has any living relatives. I still own the house. Mark gave me his half as part of the deal where I sold him my half of the business, but still sleep in my bedroom. I refuse to move into what was once my parents' bedroom, the master bedroom. I go to the local university, go Broncos, and still miss my parents and think about them every day, even though I'm 20, 21 in less than 2 weeks. Own a large home, have a lot of money in the bank. I would trade it all to have my parents back. But I don't care about the how or why of Aunt Karen's passing. Thank you for reading, and sorry for the length. Have you ever had a relative that tried to use you? If so, what did you do about it? Please let us know.
Not much anyone can use you for, Reddit boy.
You want proof that I'm actually doing my business? If you say so. Background. I'm an over-the-road truck driver, and most of the time, it's more convenient for me to do my business on the highway shoulder. I don't have to drive around and around just to park to use the restroom. Just a quick 30-second emergency stop. Do my business, either on the side of the road or empty bottles that I'm saving up. Gotta do what you gotta do when you're on the road. Then off driving again. I'm sure I'm not the only over-the-road truck driver who has done this. It's very common. Side note. According to FMCSA, by law, we have to carry logbooks to calculate our driving and on-duty time. This is relevant to the story. On to the story. This happened just a few hours ago somewhere in the I-40WB in New Mexico. I was suddenly in need to relieve myself badly. So as usual, I pulled over to a clean, wide highway shoulder. Then I put my logbook to off-duty. Note, this isn't my first time today doing my business. I have a habit of being very meticulous with my driving time. which means when I'm not doing anything, even for 30 seconds, I put my time in off duty. I tried to save as much driving time as possible. Those multiple 30 seconds can add up to a lot to avoid doing 34 hours reset too soon. I looked at the passenger side window and see multiple cars passing by. Turns out, there's a road where cars drive by on the side of the highway. Doing my business on the highway shoulder? Nope. Instead, I did the alternate route. Do it in a bottle, seal it, and stow it for trash later. Just as I finished doing my business, I heard a knock on my passenger door. Very weird, because this is the highway shoulder where no one should be randomly walking around. I stow away the bottle and go look to see who it is, and it's a cop. I was thinking, crap, this isn't happening. I switched my logbook to on-duty inspection and go answer the cop. Before I could say anything, the cop asked me to see my logbook. It's part of their job to check whether we comply to the rules or not, so I show it to him. The graph looks like a heart monitor, so I was relieving myself probably 4 or 5 times per day. Tiny bladder problem. The cop questioned why I was off duty for 30 seconds to 1 minute every 2 hours almost every day. Electronic logbook can be backtracked up to 14 days. I explained to him that I have to relieve myself every 2 hours, give or take. The cop didn't believe me and assumed that my truck had a problem. That's why I have to stop every 2 hours. I repeated myself about my bladder issue, but the cop still didn't believe me. Instead, he said,
"Unless you have proof that you're actually relieving yourself, I'm afraid I have to give you a ticket for false usage of logbook."
Cue malicious compliance. I told the cop to wait a moment and went back inside my cabin. I grabbed every single bottle that I had filled today and the previous day. I haven't had the chance to throw it away. Put it in a plastic bag and for extra measure, grabbed the newest one out of the plastic bag. It was still warm. I showed the whole bag to the cop, plus the warm bottle. Told him it's the newest one I just did a few seconds ago and asked if he would like to hold it for further inspection. The cop had the mixed look of disgust and horror. He was literally gagging, so I put back the evidence inside of my truck so he could recover. Then the cop says,
"I was expecting a doctor's note or something like that. What you showed me was disgusting."
Me, but you asked for proof that I was, in fact, relieving myself. I was holding back my laughter so hard that my cheeks started to hurt. Then he gave me back my logbook and told me to have a good day, then drives off. Have a good day indeed. I took an extra 1 minute on the shoulder to laugh until I was satisfied. Then I'm off to driving again. Edit. For those who asked, did I do anything on my logbook during laughter, you all have asked the most important question. Bravo. I did set it as off-duty, but did not put a comment on it. I guess, in the eyes of my dispatch, it looks like I'm doing 1 minute of silence. I did get questioned by my dispatch, and after thorough explaining, he too did a 1 minute of silence. Am I the jerk for making my neighbor remove the eggs he put in my yard for an Easter egg hunt? Since Wednesday, my neighbor asked if he could hide eggs in my 28 male yard as part of an Easter egg hunt they wanted to do for the kids coming to their barbecue. Our yards are right next to each other with only the pavement dividing it and no fence, which I'm thinking about setting up after what happened. He asked 3 times and each time I said no because I don't like the idea of a bunch of little kids that I don't know coming into my yard. Besides, he wanted to hide most of them in my garden and I wouldn't trust a 6-year-old not to step on my flowers or knock over a pot. He's been mad since I repeatedly said no and explained why. Their yard's just as big as mine, so I didn't see why they needed my space too. Yesterday, I was having some car trouble, so I took it to my friend who's a mechanic, not getting it back until Tuesday. So, guess because my car wasn't in my driveway, they assumed I wasn't home. Because in the morning, I'm doing work in my basement and I hear footsteps nearby. Checked my hidden security cam and I see my neighbor walking back to his house from my yard. Right away, I go outside to confront him and he looked panicked. Honestly, no idea why the heck he thought it was a good idea to do that. Like, even if I wasn't home at the time, what made him think I wouldn't get there, say, when the kids were in my yard? I was just so upset. He told me to please let them do this since the eggs were already spread out and his family was going to be home soon. At that moment, I was seriously mad. So I told him either to take all the eggs back or I'm throwing them out myself. Then he got mad and was calling me names under his breath, but he picked them up and left. I'm going out to check my yard to make sure that he got all of them and his wife is giving me a dirty look too while he was talking to her. They had their little party and Easter egg hunt in their one yard. I was out there just now watering my plants and they were cleaning up. My neighbor was still mad at me. He told me he hopes I'm happy with what I did. Right now that I'm more calm and I'm not mad at him anymore, I'm kind of wondering if I was a jerk for making him pick up his eggs and not letting them use my yard. Honestly, I was ticked off in the moment that he went into my yard after telling him no, so I'm not sure. Well, who do you think is the jerk? OP or his neighbor? Please let us know.
I would have taken those eggs and put something horrible inside of them.
Karen, how could you say something like that?
What? I just mean something no one likes, like Tootsie Rolls.
That's a boy's name. Hello, my wonderful front desk agents and front desk enthusiasts. This happened to me just yesterday at the brand new hotel I'm working at. To start, I'll give a bit of context. I'm a female with what I've been told is a boy's name. Let's just say it's Sky. The issue is, I've literally never met or even heard of someone that has the same name as me. I'll also mention that I'm working at a hotel located in a city dominated by another brand. We also just opened a few months ago, so often when people stay with us, they tend to compare us to the other brand. It was around 2 hours into my shift when the phone rang. Me. Hello, thank you for calling the fancy hotel brand. My name is Sky. How may I help you? Karen.
Hi. Are you actually at the front desk? Because I want to speak to someone on property.
Me. Slightly surprised at her bluntness. Yes, ma'am. I'm here in the city. How can I help you?
I wanted to book a reservation for my son and daughter-in-law tonight.
Me. Okay, absolutely, no problem. Were you looking to book just for the night? Karen.
Yes. You see, I just want to hear your prices. I usually stay with your competitor, but I didn't like the front desk person's attitude, so I'm looking for a new hotel. Maybe you guys might be it.
Me. Okay, well, let's see what we've got here. Were you looking for just a king bed for tonight?
Of course. They're married. They're not going to sleep on separate beds.
Me. Okay, I was just checking. It looks like that will be this amount for a king bed just for the night. That does not include breakfast.
Okay, can I just give you the card number to have him check in?
Me. Actually, it's company policy to fill out a credit card authorization form in order for us to use the card for someone other than the listed cardholder. If you give me a good email address, I can send it to you.
No, absolutely not. I'm not doing that.
Me, at a complete loss at this point. Well, it's company policy, and I unfortunately can't run your card for another guest without the form or your signature.
Can I come in and then book a reservation?
Me, yes. As long as we're able to swipe your card and have you sign for the room, we don't need the form.
Great, then I'll be in.
Me, perfect. If you come in before 3 p.m., I'll be the one you're dealing with.
Great. What was your name?
Sky, S-K-Y, and I work at the front desk.
Wait, Sky? Not Skyler?
Me, that's correct.
How do you spell that?
S-K-Y, like Skyler, without the L-E-R.
And you're a girl?
Me, now annoyed and confused about why that matters. Yes, ma'am, I am.
But that's a boy's name, and you're spelling it wrong.
Me, I'll be sure to let my parents know. Have a nice day. Am I the jerk for talking to my parents about getting a lock to keep my brother and his wife from going in my room without permission? So for a little context, I, 21, female, am still having to live at home with my parents due to lockdown messing up my plans for moving out. My parents are happy to still have me at their home, and I'm okay living with them until I can earn enough money to move out. One of my brothers, 26, male, and his wife, 26, female, tend to visit us a lot, which I don't mind. I enjoy seeing my brother. I love him very dearly, and his wife is a really sweet lady who we all get along with very well. However, my brother has a tendency to just walk into my room, whether I'm in there or not. He did this before to pet our older cat, who tended to spend most of her time in my room, and I know he loved the cat, but I also did not appreciate him just barging in without warning. He stopped doing this for a while when our old cat passed away. She will forever be missed. But I recently got two new kittens from a rescue because I felt like I needed a new cat to help me heal from the loss of my old cat. It has been amazing, but now my brother's tendency of barging in has gotten worse than it was before. I have repeatedly asked him not to barge in and that if he wants to enter my room, he needs to ask for permission first and respect my answer if I tell him no. He always says sure or okay, but it's clearly in a very dismissive way. His wife will always follow him after getting an ice cream bar from our freezer and just sit on my bed with him, eating. It's been 6 months of this routine by now, and I'm sick of it. My room is my space to be on my own and recharge and for privacy, and they continually disrespect that. I got fed up this weekend when I was trying to get ready for a date with my boyfriend, and they just barged into my room to pet the kittens who were in there with me. I asked him to please leave and that I was trying to get ready, and he said that since I am putting makeup on in the bathroom, why don't I just change in there too, and that he wants to pet the kittens. I gave up, got ready in the bathroom, and once I got home, I talked to my mother about getting a lock or something to put on my door so that they won't just go in, sit on my bed, and eat without my permission anymore. My brother heard about this because my dad, bless his heart, but he is oblivious sometimes, saw no issue saying we were going out to look for a lock when my brother asked if we were home. Brother is now saying that I'm just overreacting, that I have the kittens in there a lot of the time. They hate being away from me, so they usually follow me in there to sit on my bed and watch me as I'm doing anything in there, and he just wants to pet them. He says I'm being cruel to him and the kittens by not letting him in to pet them whenever he wants, and by apparently depriving the kittens of attention and interaction with people. I'm just so sick of him and his wife barging in, but now I'm starting to wonder, am I overreacting over this by looking at getting a lock to keep them out? Also, the sister-in-law never is the one who barges in. She usually just follows after brother a few minutes after he barges in himself. Well, what do you think? Is OP overreacting about getting a lock or not? Please let us know.
That brother needs to learn some manners. You don't just barge into your sister's room like that.
Clearly shopping at PetSmart. I'm not wearing even similar colors. I'd never heard of this sub before now, but about 2 months ago, I went into PetSmart for dog food, crickets, and a tank thermometer for my boyfriend's gecko. I had just grabbed some freeze-dried worms since they were out of small crickets, but it seemed unlikely to the worker that large crickets would have been fine for some reason. Anyways, I'm walking down the aisle, and this older lady, and what seemed like maybe her older son, or maybe it was a different type of relationship, but it seemed as though it could only be family, came up to me and said,
"Excuse me, do you know where the fishnets are?"
Now, I understand that by answering her, I may have led on that I did work there, but I couldn't ignore her because I knew the general area, so I said, "I think in the next aisle." She thanked me and left to the other aisle. I was picking out a thermometer that wasn't going to break the bank, and I was walking towards the dog food, but kind of taking my sweet time as I was enjoying the time alone. She stopped me before I could get to the dog food section and said,
"They're not here. Where are they?"
in a snappy tone. I'm somewhat of an easily irritated person, but I was trying to calm down because she probably thought I worked there for a crazy reason. So I said, I'm not really sure. You can ask that employee. And I pointed out the guy who was adamant on freeze-dried worms for me. She turned back around and said,
"I asked you. I want to speak to a manager."
When she said that, I actually felt something snap a little, because I don't go out of my way to be nice to people ever. I'm only ever civil and blunt. So because this was a wasted rare occurrence, I just said, "Well, I don't know where it is, but maybe if you actually ask someone who works here, you'd be able to figure it out. Or you can open your eyes in the fish section." I stuttered a little bit on the word fish, and that bummed me out. But I walked away quickly, irritated and hoping I didn't see her again. Not super exciting, but it was one of the better moments of being assertive. After years of retail, my normal response would have been to be polite, but I'm through with retail forever if I can help it. By the way, the PetSmart uniform is khakis and a royal blue t-shirt. I was wearing a black tank top and jeans with a black bomber's jacket on. Not even close.
Forward the complaint to the owner? Okay, no problem. My wife used to be an apartment manager for 190 unit complex. It was a live-in situation, so we didn't have to pay utilities or rent. We did, however, have to deal with residents knocking on our door all day and sometimes night, despite having clear office hours of 10 to 6. We had a weekend manager who had no authority but could show apartments and help with lockouts. The owner of the complex was a dishonest ex-con, and to this day, I have no idea how he got the money to build the complex. This guy was notorious for squeezing every penny out of residents that he could. When signing the lease, it was clearly explained by my wife that everything must be taken from the apartments when residents moved out. There was a strict $100 charge for all larger items that were not removed, things like beds, furniture, televisions, etc. This would all come out of the deposit made at the time of signing. When residents told my wife they were moving, she would again remind them to remove everything from the apartment or they would not receive their full deposit. One resident who had moved out over the weekend and had a conversation with the weekend manager. Again, the weekend manager had no authority.
This resident stated that the weekend manager said it was okay to leave a few items, and that someone would come claim the items as their own, and that the items would be gone before final checks. When my wife went to go look over the vacated apartment, she found a TV stand, and a desk. She then checked with the weekend manager, who said they never told the prior resident they could leave items behind. My wife had maintenance come and dispose of the three large items, but rather than charge the typical $300, she only charged $100. My wife then called the prior resident, explaining that they had left a few items, but only $100 would come out of their $700 deposit. The prior residents were furious with my wife and aggressively claimed that weekend managers said it was okay to leave items. My wife explained over and over that the policy is to have everything gone and that she was actually saving them $200. The prior residents were having none of it and would call over and over, yelling at my wife to fix it. The prior residents demanded that this be escalated to the owner. So my wife forwarded the emails from the prior residents and explained that they had been charged $100. The owner read the emails and thought my wife had mistakenly charged $100 instead of $300. The owner then told my wife to withhold $300 from the $700 instead of the prior $100 charge, and the check went out to the prior residents for $400. The prior residents threatened to sue and still called for a while, but after a while they gave up and moved on. Sometimes people should just accept kind gestures rather than throw a temper tantrum. Can't wait for me to test a lawnmower? Help yourself. Grabbed a broken lawnmower from outside of someone's house this morning and was reminded of this story. I'm part of a group who keep a community garden and help local people get into gardening too. We let people know we will take any old tools and equipment, as we can often repair, restore, or just sharpen stuff and it's as good as new. And we just give it back or away in exchange for a small donation. It's not uncommon to see mowers, trimmers, etc. outside of houses in the summer for the scrap man, and we always snag them. Easily 75% of the electrical stuff we get, maybe even as much as 90%, just needs a fuse or a new plug and it's good to go. You leave electrical gear in a damp garage all winter and it'll need some attention, but people just chunk it out. So a few years ago, I'm working on the garden and hear someone say,
Hey, excuse me, someone said I can get a mower here?
This is already a bad start. We're British for crying out loud. What's happened to please and thank you and sorry? It was a guy who looked like what I can only describe as a big posh sod, and as I started into my normal spiel about welcome to our garden, he cut me off and asked where he could get a lawnmower, as someone said he could get a free one here. No problem. Maybe he's some weirdo who doesn't want to hear about how the broad beans are doing well this year. We actually had two lawnmowers that had been dropped off that weekend, a little hover mower that I had already fixed, rewired plug, and a massive overworked model with adjustable cutting lengths, automatic compressing grass box, etc. I hadn't touched it because 1, they're massively complicated, and 2, they're expensive, so no one gives them to us unless they're completely out of warranty. I told the guy he could take the small one, but the other one was probably broken, but he looked it up on his phone and decided he wanted it. He tried it, it started, he took it, done. Glad to see the back of it. An hour later, my phone rings.
Hi, I got your number from your website. I picked up a lawnmower about an hour ago, but it only runs for a few minutes and cuts out. Can I bring it back?
Ah, sorry, mate. I literally just got rid of a broken one of those. I really don't want another. Sorry, I can't help. Click. Am I the jerk for not letting my in-laws see their grandson again? So when I was 20, I found out I was pregnant and was living with an unstable family member. So 3 months before I had my baby, I moved in with my partner and his family. The plan was to live there for a year to save, and when the baby was around 10 months old, get our own place. So my son was born in April, and my in-laws became very controlling and tried to act like his parents, such as they are renovating the house and said on top of our rent, we have to each do 4 full days of work while they take care of the baby. They wouldn't listen to any of our parenting decisions and kept having people over during lockdown to meet him when I wasn't even letting my parents meet him due to trying to keep him safe from getting sick. Now, about a week ago, my partner spent the day doing the renovations and they asked him to hose down the driveway when he was done. Fine, he did it for 3 hours and came in to spend time with our baby after working 6 days and doing work on the house with every spare minute after, so he had hardly seen our son in a week. Now his mom came in and said he didn't do a good enough job and had him keep going. He said no, he wanted to be with his son and it was dark, he'd finish tomorrow. His mom went crazy and kicked us out at 8 p.m. said she'd call the cops if we didn't go and we didn't get back the rent we paid 2 days before. Okay, we leave and have been living in a hotel while we look for a rental. Also, I live in Victoria, Australia, where we are in a hard lockdown and have around 500 new cases every day. The state is being very strict and things aren't going well here. She's now sending me messages saying to leave her son and come back to live with her with my baby, saying we don't have to pay rent anymore if I leave him, she'll take care of us, she misses her grandchild, etc. I'm so angry that she made my family, let alone my 3-month-old son, homeless during such a risky time, or at all to be honest, and she thinks we're living in the car, not a hotel. I'm angry she's trying to get me to leave her son, who I love and have a child with. I'm ready to block her and her husband and not let them be in our lives anymore. They threw us out, and even though my son is too young to know what's going on, he's been very unsettled being in a new place and not having any of his things. It's been hard on him and made us feel like bad parents. I don't think she deserves to be in our lives, but I do believe my son deserves to know his family and have grandparents. So, would I be the jerk if I took that away from him after what they have done to us? Edit. To answer a common question, yes, it was illegal for her to kick us out, but my partner works a job that pays cash, so our rent was paid in cash and we didn't have a signed agreement, meaning we can't prove we paid rent and therefore prove that it was illegal. Karen coworker demands I do her job for her. I, 22, male, and this coworker just recently got hired as first-time zookeepers in the past couple of months. She seemed nice enough when I met her, and we didn't talk a whole lot as our work didn't overlap. She's being trained on small mammals, whereas I'm a swing keeper, basically a junior keeper who fills in as an assistant as needed. But a couple of weeks ago, she told me that she needs help cleaning the otter's dens and wants me to do it every single day for the foreseeable future instead of her, which, from my limited experience in that enclosure, was not news I was thrilled to hear. I asked her why I'd need to do it every day, since that's part of her job. She told me that she's pregnant and the smell in there is making her sick. I said, "They're otters. That smell makes everyone feel sick." But she insisted. I said, "No. Why should I have to spend half an hour in there every single day on top of everything else I already have to do?" But she got mad and I reluctantly gave it a go that day. It was a miserable 30 minutes. The next day, she insisted again, but I put my foot down. I told her I hate the otter smell too, and I had other things to do besides do her job for her. I said I'd be willing to help with the cleaning for any other small animals, but not the otters. But she insisted I help with the otters and said I was being insensitive to her needs. In the end, we got in a bit of a fight and our supervisor got involved and basically took her side and asked me if I could spare some time each day to clean the otter dens, and that this was part of giving reasonable accommodation for her pregnancy, which I just didn't think was fair. And now the coworker won't speak to me. Am I the jerk? Well, who do you think is the jerk? OP or his coworker? Please let us know.
Please do leave a comment, I can't wait to read them.
Am I the jerk for not going to Easter because it's always all about the kids? I'm 26, 2 kids, and 4 out of 5 sisters have kids, with the exception of Serena, who is a travel the world with a knapsack kind of gal. I love my family, but every single family outing, get together, every dinner, lunch, everything has to be family friendly and kid centric. I can never get my sisters, other than Serena, when she's even in town, to go to a movie, have lunch, sit and chat without it being all about the kids. Even if the kids are having a kid playtime with each other and the adults are sitting around drinking coffee, the conversations are about the kids. Kids are called over to talk to us, etc., etc. Before lockdown, I asked my sister Julie to come over with me to get our nails done and just have some us time. She changed her mind last minute and said she was bringing her daughter as a bonding activity. We do nothing but bonding activities, and the same thing has happened time and time again. Shopping? The kids need to come. Taking a hike? All on board. I expressed my frustration, and she acted like I was being super out of line, shocked, and went on about how she can't imagine doing things without her mini-me, and that it was weird. It became a whole, "Are you okay? Are you sure? Are you depressed?" thing. The requisite Zoom family things were all about the kids with no adult time, so when we were talking about getting together for Easter, I thought, hey, maybe they'll want to catch up. I asked during a planning call, "Do you think we can maybe just have some time for the adults when the kids are playing, so we can all catch up?" My mom and sisters acted like it was the most ridiculous ask. Mom did the, "Are you okay?" and I can't imagine wanting to spend time with my family and exclude you girls from any part of it. That's not normal. I said that I really can't sit through another kid-centric get-together, and that if we aren't going to at least do something and sit down and have cake and coffee together and catch up, just the family, then count me out. Well, they went through with it, and I ended up sending the girls over and staying home and having a great time, just me and Serena. She said that she understands how I feel, and she stands with me, because they exclude her as well since she doesn't have kids and has been clear that she never will. Of course, she and I are being talked down to and told that we're jerks to treat family like that, that we should have all been together as a family, and that it's time to grow up and accept that it'll never just be the sisters again. I cried about this a lot. Am I really wrong here? Is this normal and I just need to accept never seeing my other sisters one-on-one without their kids being the focus of everything? Guys, just a couple of points because it keeps coming up. I didn't ask for a kid-free Easter at all. I asked for some time for the adults to drink coffee and catch up with each other while the kids were playing. And I have friends, but family and friends are different. Well, who do you agree with? OP or the rest of their family? Please let us know.
For lots of people, once they have kids, their kids become the center of their life and everything else revolves around them. It's kind of just the life they choose to live. Try not to get too upset over it.
Work is 8 to 4 only. Not me, but my coworker, and I am super proud of them. The past few years, I've been putting up firm boundaries with work after being done over a few times, including not being expected to answer emails or do assignments evenings and weekends. It's taken a long time, but I've learned my worth and that my time is valuable. Our company has about 200 employees, but I work most closely with one other person who I've been encouraging to do the same. We were all put on remote work since last March, and recently the building opened again, with the exception that we would start back in person. I'll give props to them. They've done a ton of work to get the building cleaned, the air filters updated, enforcing masking, etc. However, HR at first talked a lot about how they would be willing to be flexible, since most schools are still closed and people needed childcare worked out, and that they would grant accommodations with people who had health concerns. Yet, that didn't actually play out. In my situation, I had a unique childcare concern that had a simple solution, but they refused to budge. Long story short, I needed to start 30 minutes later and was told no. Several other coworkers have shared similar stories of not getting any flexibility whatsoever. My coworker has several health issues and requested to work on an alternate schedule and was told, "The job is 8 to 4, so that's when you must be here." Understandably, they were upset. We've both been there well over a decade, and it's kind of a slap in the face to dedicate yourself to a place that talks up community and family, and then told no after being promised flexibility. Here's the malicious compliance. The company handles missed time by covering in-house. So for instance, if someone has a meeting at a certain time or calls in sick, someone who has a break or lunch covers them and gets paid a little stipend for it. We're talking like $20, not much. But if you take a few extras over a week, it can add up to a nice little bit in your pay. My coworker coordinates all of this and does it on Sunday for the upcoming week. Even though they don't work on Sunday, they would say it only takes about an hour to do, and it makes everyone's life so much easier since everyone walks in Monday morning knowing who is covering when, so it's worth it. Can you see where this is going? Upset at the lack of accommodation, my coworker decided to take HR's word for it. They stopped sending the coverage email on the weekend and did it at 8 sharp on Monday. It was like the end of the world. Everyone was scrambling. Such a little thing to make life convenient, but they refuse now to do anything outside of work hours. They told me that the following weekend, managers were asking for it throughout Saturday and Sunday, but they ignored the emails. On Monday, they sent it at 8 a.m. sharp again. By the afternoon, the head boss had asked them to please resume doing it on the weekend, and they are now getting the extra hour paid by the company. I loved it. Take care of your employees, and they take care of you. Give a little, get a little. Here's some info asked about in the comments. 1. My coworker doesn't have a disability, but is nearing retirement age and has some minor medical concerns that could make getting sick very complicated. 2. From what I understand, they requested to continue remotely, and I'm not surprised that was denied. While their role could be done at home, with people back in the building, it wouldn't make much sense. They do a lot of the front office stuff, where my role is more in the background. I could do my job no problem going in only once a week, but their role really does need to be on site while people are there. I believe they had asked to do some days at home or half days at home. That would work if HR had let them. 3. It seems from what I have gathered, only 2 people were granted remote accommodations. One person I know has some complicated medical issues, so that made sense to me. Most people asking for flexibility have roles that, like mine, don't necessitate being on site. I was told that my requested accommodation would be unfair because everyone needs to be treated equally, and I get that, except most work with clients and I don't. My role is completely internal support. There are others like me who do back-end stuff or support in other ways who were denied what I consider minor accommodations in the spirit of fairness, but would make life a million times easier. Am I the jerk for excluding my brother's kids from some family events? Context. I come from a large family and it's considered really normal to help out or ask for help, and we often watch each other's kids, pick things up for each other, run errands, etc. I would describe us as laid back and generally low conflict. If people have an issue with something someone does, we usually address it with them privately so as to not embarrass them. The problem. One of my brothers is married to my sister-in-law, and they have kids, all under the age of 7. Sister-in-law has really specific ideas about parenting and what her kids should be allowed to do. She expects us to abide by her rules when her kids are at other family members' houses with the rest of the cousins. If the rules aren't followed, she doesn't say anything directly, but instead sends an email to the person with clear instructions on what they did wrong. The emails read like something from a boss. This happened a number of times over the years, but an event that happened last fall caused the current issues. During lockdown, my mom has been babysitting the kids in our pod during the day and helping them with virtual school. Often, there are 5+ kids there at a time. One of sister-in-law's rules is that her kids cannot have any food with dyes in it. No allergy, it's a general health thing. My mom forgot and gave one of her kids a popsicle during the day because everyone else was having one. The kid was eating it when sister-in-law picked them up, and while she didn't say anything at the time, it was clear she was upset. My mom then received an email that began,
"Our recent discussion. It was my understanding that you understood that my kid cannot have food with dyes in it."
It then contained bullet points suggesting how she could improve. My mother was really insulted. In addition, sister-in-law CC'd my dad. He went to their house to speak with them, and sister-in-law apologized for her communication style, but pushed back on the dye thing and wanted an apology from my mom. My mom apologized, but also no longer watches their kids regularly, by her own choice. Ever since that happened, everyone is pretty cautious around them and their kids. If we're doing something that might violate her rules, we don't invite them. This is honestly most things we do, because the stuff she bans, exposure to any form of violence, refined sugars, dyes, yelling, playground equipment above 5 feet, etc., are not things we have issues with, within reason, with our own kids. Recently, my brother asked me and my other siblings about it, and we were honest. We feel like we're walking on eggshells around them. He says she communicates about serious topics through email because of her anxiety disorder. He defends her behavior as mama bear tendencies and thinks we can slowly help her by being patient. We refused. Are we the jerks for excluding my nieces and nephews? When we have big family get-togethers again, they will always be invited, but not always for other stuff. Edit. Also, just to say, my sister-in-law is often really fun and pleasant. It's really just the parenting issues that she's so controlling about. We never had issues with her before they had kids. Well, who do you think is the jerk? OP or sister-in-law? Please let us know.
Those poor babies are gonna miss out on a lot in life if their mama doesn't stop acting like that. And tell Papa he's just as guilty as long as he lets that crap go on. Seriously though, my heart goes out to those kids.
Stop working so hard? Don't mind if I do. This is ongoing, so keeping things vague. The background. I work in a corporate setting on a mixed team. The team is made up of a few different roles, each with their own reporting structure. I'm the only person reporting up to my manager on the team. I'm pretty much on my own for the day-to-day. The story. For the first half of last year, I worked for senior manager, that will be his name, on a mixed team. Some people on that team were rock stars, others were not. I've always been a go-getter, perfectionist kind of person. So on that team, I didn't let things slip through the cracks, which meant that sometimes, often, I did things beyond my specific role. Halfway through last year, I moved to a new team and thus reported to awesome manager for the second half. Again, I'm the only one for my role on this new team. Cue the new year, and with it, performance reviews. This is the one time, outside of promotion, that you can get a raise. I've busted my butt on the new team, and everyone I work with has shown appreciation, and this company actually did well last year, so funds are not a problem. Awesome Manager is the one conducting my review, and they asked Senior Manager for feedback since I did report to him for the first half. Awesome Manager says I'm doing an amazing job. Keep it up. Here are some suggestions. A senior VP of the company loves showing off something I made. Senior Manager's notes say to not pick up every piece. Allow others to fail sometimes so that they can grow and learn and better themselves. Then Awesome Manager informs me that the average rage percentage is 3%. Awesome Manager tells me they recommended I get a 4% raise. They then tell me that all of the senior managers met for the whole organization to coordinate, and coming out of that meeting, I am getting 3%. Awesome Manager cannot get a straight answer why my raise was decreased. So since Senior Manager was part of that meeting where they cut down my raise, I'm following his direction. Take on less. I've cut back to okay employee work ethic and am letting others fail and grow. Since I'm alone on my role for the team and Awesome Manager just got moved elsewhere, I have another new manager, no one can call me out. In the meantime, I'm spending that extra energy prepping my resume for more reasons than just this. A couple of clarifications. Yes, the average raise really just keeps up with inflation. Awesome Manager did not promise me the higher percentage. They explained the whole story in that same meeting, basically giving me a peek behind the curtain. And I don't think Senior Manager was malicious. He just didn't fight hard enough for me, and he's the one that did have a say. Am I the jerk for not wanting to house my sister's fiance? My sister, 27, female, has been with her fiance, Dale, for 3 years. My family and myself, 28, male, absolutely cannot stand him. From day one, he was just this rude, obnoxious slob, and we don't have a clue what she sees in this guy. He's 30 and can't hold down a job for anything. Either he quits because he doesn't like it, or he gets fired after many absences. We're embarrassed to even go out to a restaurant with him because he will throw a fit over something in his food to try to get a free meal. I try to avoid interactions with him when I can because I can't stand him. With the lockdown, my sister got laid off, and they moved in with a friend a few months ago to save up on money, especially because they found out my sister is pregnant 3 months ago. Now my sister tells me Dale and his friend got into some dispute, so they can't live there anymore. She's asking if it's okay if they stayed with me for a while, but I don't think that's going to happen. Aside from Dale being a jerk in general, I've heard he's an even bigger pain to live with. Before the lockdown, there was a whole drama with the landlord at his old place. Dale stopped paying rent and then was refusing to leave, even after being given an eviction notice. No idea how it went down, but he managed to stay there longer until the landlord could go through the whole court process to get him out. My sister told me all about it because she was having fights with Dale trying to get him to just leave already. The last thing I want is to invite that possible headache into my home knowing what a freeloader he is. Might even be harder right now if I decided I didn't want him in my house anymore with some places still putting evictions on hold. I told my sister my concerns. She swears Dale wouldn't do that, but she couldn't even convince him to move out of the last place he was staying at. Now, I get she's pregnant, and I told her I'd be more than happy to give her a place to stay, just not Dale. She's pretty mad I'm not willing to help him out as well and for not trusting them. They're supposed to be moving out by next week with still no place to go. I told my sister my offer still stands for her, but I can't accept Dale with his history. She says I'm an awful brother and can't believe how badly I'm acting in their time of need. Am I being a jerk for going down this route? Well, what would you do in this situation? Would you let them come stay at your house or not? Please let us know.
No way! I would offer them directions to the nearest Motel 6. I've heard they leave the lights on for you.
I got a male Karen, a Chad, arrested. I, 20, female, run a retail store with only one other person, another 20-year-old female, and some guy comes in and cussed at her. Literally, the first thing he said to her was, "Forget you." I took over and told the man, somewhere in his 50s, we wouldn't help him if he was gonna talk to us like that. He made fun of me for telling him he couldn't swear, and I just ignored him and gave him the solution to the problem he was coming in about. I watched him run outside to his truck, check his backseat multiple times, important to remember, and after about 15 to 20 minutes, he came back in. He sat down and just glared at me. My coworker was helping someone else. I asked him what he needed. He said he'd tell me after our only other customer left. I told him he could tell me now. He stood up and said,
"I will leave when she leaves."
I responded saying, "Listen, I've been nothing but pleasant with you, and your entire time of being here, you've been incredibly hostile. I'm giving you two options. You can either talk to me right now so I can try to help you, or you can leave, Because at this point, what you're doing, sitting down and saying nothing, is loitering. He was angry. He got right up in my face to intimidate me and gave me the most evil look I'd ever received. I stared right back at him. What is it going to be? He broke eye contact and said,
I'll leave.
He walked out the door, but he did not leave. He sat in the front of his truck and kept looking through our window at us, waiting for our only customer to leave. I pointed this out to both my coworker and the customer, an older woman. The older woman told me to call the cops immediately and that the man was not mentally sound. I was hesitant, but she was right. I called the cops, but in the meantime, the man kept checking his back seat over and over again. When the cops arrived, they said hi to me first and then went outside to speak to the man. After about 5 minutes, I saw Mr. Karen trying to fight the cops. One of them later came back in and told me the situation.
So, he's going to jail tonight. There was something in the back seat of his truck that he's going to jail for.
He was actually a wanted man. Are you all good here? One of us can stay here if you don't feel safe. I told him that we were fine. He had me write up a witness report. Makes me wonder what was in the back of this guy's truck. Am I the jerk for not letting my boyfriend drive my dad's Ferrari? My dad is wealthy. Not like mega rich billionaire wealthy, but pretty darn wealthy. My dad owns this Ferrari V12 supercar that he loves. He takes it out to drive a few times a month when he can and usually likes to take it to a local track. He's very protective of that car and doesn't want anyone driving it. He let me drive it once at his track and I had like a race car driver instructor with me. But honestly, I'm sort of afraid of it. It's really powerful and just more car than I can handle. Anyways, I'm dating this dude and he saw my dad's car when he was over and he asked me if he could drive it. I told him he would have to ask my dad because it's not mine and that I don't think he would want to let him drive it because my dad doesn't really want anyone driving it. Anyways, he left it alone. He brought it up to my dad later, but my dad said no. My dad said he let me drive it once at a track with a race car driver in the passenger seat and that he just doesn't trust anyone else to drive it. So my dad went out of town and now my boyfriend is asking me to let him drive the car while my dad is gone. He keeps asking me where the keys are and can he just take it for a spin? And I keep telling him no, and it's making me uncomfortable he keeps asking. Finally, he got mad at me and started calling me names and said I should be supportive of him, that I should understand he doesn't have a rich family and will probably never have this opportunity again, and that if I loved him, I would do this for him. I don't know. I get that he doesn't really have another opportunity to drive this car, but like, it's just a car, and my dad would be really upset if I let him. Am I the jerk? I believe I might be the jerk because my boyfriend can't afford a car like this on his own, and I feel bad that I'm denying the opportunity to drive one, which is something he really wants, and I am denying his dream. Edit. So that people know, I did take the keys and put them in my dad's safe about 30-ish minutes after this post went up. A lot of people have mentioned he doesn't see a long-term relationship with me because he said, this is the only chance I'll get. I honestly didn't register that, but yeah, it's got me thinking. Well, what would you do in this situation? Would you let him drive the car or not? Please let us know.
OP, you need to break up with this guy. He sounds like a manipulative little entitled jerk. Kind of reminds me of myself before I went to that Karen's retreat.
Am I the jerk for not supporting my daughter and grandchild? My husband, 51, male, and I, 49, female, have a daughter who's 21, Amanda. We plan for our children's future with a college fund and a small amount of money to get them started. As a teacher, I've always believed that college is not always for everyone and did not want to force this if our kids were not interested. We also let them know that this money was not their money, but ours, and we would not be using it so they could just live. We raised our kids to be responsible for their actions and the consequences of said actions, which brings us to the issue. About 2 years ago, while at college, Amanda met a guy, Tony, who was 24. Tony was not a student, but he lived in the college town. We met him a few times and were not impressed by him or his life goals. She and I are close, and a few times over the course of the relationship, she mentioned issues that were red flags to me. When she asked for advice, I was honest, and if she told me to back off, I would. When lockdown classes went virtual, so dorms closed, Tony invited her to move in with him and his family. We would have rather she had come home. In the summer, Tony suggested that they move in with us because his family had taken our daughter in for 3 months. I should probably mention that our home is a few blocks from the ocean and a couple of towns from a popular summer hangout. We told our daughter she could come home, but not Tony. Tony was very upset by this and said if she came without him, it was over. She ended up staying with him and found out she was pregnant last July. She and Tony arrived with a plan. The plan was basically us supporting them as they would be raising our grandchild. We rejected this plan, and I was able to get my daughter alone. I explained the reality of what her life would look like with Tony and their child. I let her know that while we would still pay for college, we would not pay for a place to live, childcare, Tony, baby expenses, etc. I also let her know that while she could always visit, she could not return home full-time with a baby, as we are nearing retirement and a baby is just not part of that plan. We talked about options, and I let her know that she was free to do what was right for her and Tony, but that they should not plan on any support from us beyond what a grandparent would do. She talked to him and went ahead with a pregnancy. Amanda has always understood that her actions are her responsibility, but Tony has not seemed to grasp the concept. He asks weekly for favors and help that we already said we would not do. Tony's family thinks we are the jerks for not providing more help, and his mother thinks that we are punishing them for not doing things the right way. Most of my family thinks we are right because Amanda and Tony knew what we would provide before moving forward with the pregnancy, and if they were not in the position to have a child, then they shouldn't have had one. Well, what do you think? Is OP a jerk or not? Please let us know.
Actions always have consequences. Let this be a lesson to always stay away from people like Tony. Also, don't be like him.
Am I the jerk for telling my father that my ex wouldn't give me my bracelet back? My ex, 19, male, and I, 18, female, broke up last Wednesday after 6 months. It was very abrupt, and he never fully explained why, other than saying he forgave me. I tried the best I could with my emotional control issues to make sure the relationship was healthy, but it was hard because I was his first love and he didn't know how to communicate properly. He messaged me on Saturday saying he was sorry for ignoring me, and I started asking him questions about what happened and how he could already be over me. He refused to answer and just kept telling me he didn't love me. I asked for my bracelet back and he told me he would give it back soon. I asked more questions, which I now realize made him uncomfortable. But instead of telling me this, he just blocked me once more. I didn't want to just move on because I've had the bracelet since I was 12, so I messaged his brother and he talked to him for me. He messaged me 3 hours later. We arranged to meet today, but last night he said his family was sick so I couldn't come over and that we should reschedule. I understood and asked when we could meet up and that I didn't even have to come over. It was late, so he said we could talk about it in the morning. I woke up to a message from him saying he didn't want to see me and that he didn't think he should give back the bracelet because I gave it to him as a way of me always being with him and he didn't want me to vanish from his life. I tried to contact him, but I had no luck and started to have a panic attack because of how important the bracelet was to me. I got it from my nan who recently passed for my 12th birthday. My dad got home when I was having my panic attack, so I told him everything. He got my ex's number from my phone and called him. He told him to give the bracelet back or he would call the police. I thought calling the police was an overreaction. My ex messaged me saying he would give it back and we agreed to meet up tomorrow. I feel like I never should have told my father and I didn't want to cause trouble for him. I just wanted my bracelet back. Am I the jerk for telling my dad my ex wouldn't give me my bracelet back? Edit. I forgot to mention I gave it to him temporarily while we were together. He said he would be sure to give it back if we broke up. Well, what do you think? Was OP the jerk for telling her dad or not? Please let us know.
Of course not. That's what dads are for. If you get mixed up with a psycho, part of dad's job is making things right. By the way, where did you meet that boyfriend? The guy sounds like he needs to be locked up somewhere.
Karen harasses me in my own home and makes a fool of herself. I live in a ground floor apartment in the middle of my little town with a small courtyard at the back. There's a lovely set of glass sliding doors that open from the living room into said courtyard, and on the other side of the courtyard fence is a public footpath, with a public car park behind it. It's lunchtime here at the moment, so there's a person walking past every 5 minutes or so. It's also useful to know for context that I'm physically disabled and use a walking stick. My genetic disorder, Ehlers-Danlos syndrome, also makes me look significantly younger than I am, so despite being 31 years old, I'm often mistaken for a teenager. Especially by Karens, for whom I seem to be a magnet. Anyway, onto the story. So I was sitting on my sofa, watching TV and eating my lunch, when I spotted one of those little black millipedes on the carpet. We get a lot of them at this time of the year, so I used an empty box to scoop it up and chuck it over the fence, so that it hopefully won't come back into the apartment. No big deal, right? There was this Karen walking along the footpath, a fair way down from our fence, and she yelled something like,
"I saw what you just did!"
I didn't think she was barking at me, since I hadn't done anything wrong or unusual, so I went back inside. She then appeared at our back gate, shouting at me for throwing rubbish over the fence and littering. I told her I had thrown a millipede over the fence that I'd found on the carpet. She accused me of lying and said she'd seen me throw a box. I opened the fly screen and held up the empty box and said, "You mean this one?" She froze and stammered a bit before saying,
"Well, obviously, you threw something else then."
Like I was being the idiot here. I said, "Then where is it?" And this lady actually started scouring the flower bed between the footpath and the car park for the imaginary rubbish she was adamant I'd thrown. I guess she found nothing she could reasonably accuse me of having thrown out there, because she came back to the fence and barked,
"If I ever catch you littering again, missy, you'll be dealing with the police."
So I said, "Sure, I'd love to tell them about you harassing a disabled woman in her own home. We'll see how that goes for you." And she stormed off. What the heck? I get dealing with Karens in the wild, but in my own home? Wish I'd thought to snap a photo of her just in case. Hindsight is 20/20.
Support our channel by joining as a member today, and we'll give you a shout out in our next video.
Or come watch this video next. You won't believe what Karen does in that one.